We have two renowned panel of experts today. Professor Radia Sultana Mahmood is the ex-professor. She is the ex-professor of cardiology of NICPD Dhaka. And also we have got Dr. AQM Reza. He is the professor and senior consultant of cardiology of Evercare Hospital, that is the former Apollo Hospital of Dhaka. Before starting the program, I have one announcement that one of the main motto of this program to have a good interactive session. For this reason, we expect more and more participation for the junior fellows, actually for which the program is dedicated. So I like to request all the participants, especially the junior participants, to participate in the interaction throughout the program, especially when the time is allowed for interaction. And if you are going to put questions in the chat box or question and answer part, you can do that. Also, you can raise your hands, not practical hands, but in the panel just displayed below. And in that case, we will take you into view so that you can directly interact with the panel of experts and others. Before starting the program, may I request Professor Abdullah Shafi Majumdar to say a few words regarding today's program. Sir, please.
Very good morning. It is our great honor to have honorable speaker, Professor Brigadier General Noor Fatima, who is not only a renowned international pediatric cardiologist, she is also have got the highest civil award from Bangladesh government, that is the Shadhinata Padok. So we feel honored to have her as the speaker in our this session. And also we have got the Dr. Govinda Kumar Pal, who is a very young person who becomes the speaker in this session. And I hope that we will enjoy both the presentations. And before that, may I repeat again to the fellows to actively participate in the sessions, either by putting the questions in the question and answers or chat box, and also by raising your hand so that you may be on video, and then you can directly interact with the panel of experts or the speakers. And this is actually meant for the junior fellows and the third part or the final part students of the postgraduate students of the cardiology. So I expect their participations more actively than the others. And also, we are keeping records of the participations of the fellows in these sessions, so that at the end of our this whole program, we can issue a certificate of attendance of the echocardiographic workshop, who attended it regularly. We will recognize their participation. With these words, and only a few words, that the professor Ismail Patori is with us. He's a professor of medicine. We are very happy that he joined with us. And also our senior colleagues, Professor Abdulwadud Chowdhury, Professor Chowdhury Meshkat, all Professor Sabina Hashim, Professor Salam, Professor Tuinok, all joined us. And also our mid-levels, and they're also become seniors, actually. The Dr. Khalikuzzaman, the Dr. Kobiruzzaman, also very senior. They are all with us. And so we are very happy that our today's session will be very meaningful and helpful. With these words, and welcoming all the welcoming the speakers and the moderators and the panelists, as well as our the faculty and the fellows, I like to ask Manwar to make the next program. What is in your hand? The presentation. Thank you, sir. Yeah.
Thank you, sir. Dear participants, I often feel happy and at the same time envious whenever I utter the names of so many Padma Bhushans and Padma Sris and equivalents. And today I am also happy that we have also got one such legends in our country, and who is, as sir has already mentioned, that she is the Shadhinata Padok awardee. This is the highest just recognition, state recognition in Bangladesh. So we are talking about Brigadier General Professor Noor Unnahar Fatema. And another important aspect that she is still in government service. And during serving as a government servant, she has received this award. Needless to say that she is a renowned pediatric cardiologist in Bangladesh. And if I go back to her initial days, she graduated from Sylhet M.A.G. Osmani Medical College in 1962. And she graduated from Sylhet M.A.G. Osmani Medical College in 1985. And ultimately, she had her FCPS from Bangladesh College of Physicians and Surgeons, and then she was trained in Prince Sultan Cardiac Center in Riyadh, KSA. And after returning home, she devoted herself in development of pediatric cardiology in CMH and also in the country. She has so many innovations. And she, besides rendering her excellent service, she invented a few techniques in interventional cardiology. The important one among those is the NNF protocol for primary pulmonary hypertension and cyanotic spell that is widely followed in the field of pediatric cardiology. And besides services and academic pursuits, she is also a social worker. She has been involved in a number of charitable works, and as a result of her lifetime service, she has been awarded the highest award in Bangladesh, as I have already mentioned. Today, she will talk on pediatric cardiology interventions, and let us have the session. I think this will be a very good one. After this end of this session, we will have a brief break. During this time, we have chance to interact, and this will be followed by our next session on MODICO cardiography. So let us enjoy the session. Madam, please.
Thank you, Dr. Mahmoud, for telling so many things about me. I don't know whether I deserve, but what is true is that I always try to work. I am a very hard worker. That is true. And in this corona season, you all are cardiologists. Maybe you have some relaxation in the work, because most of us are not doing like chambers and not going to those who are more than 50 years. They have some relaxation in the service also, those who are in the service. But for me, still I have to work day and night, because I am the head of pediatrics, not only in CMHS Dhaka, but all over the Bangladesh, all CMHS. I am the advisor for all the pediatricians. So throughout the COVID season, we are deploying many, many doctors in many places, even in medicine department. They are running with a shortage of the staff, shortage of doctor because of the pandemic, and we have so many patients in CMH. At a time, sometime in initially 1,200 patients, like 1,000 patients. So we deployed our pediatricians, cardiologists, everyone to the COVID units to work as the medical officer, and still now they are working there. So every time we have to reshuffle, we have to send people not only in Dhaka to other places like Borishal. So we are all the time, we are busy, and we are writing protocols, we are changing protocols, because every day treatment protocols are changing. So we are also preparing protocols at least once in a month for the corona also. So we are too busy with all these things. And today I want to acknowledge my thanks and heartfelt gratitude to Professor Shofi Majumdar sir. He told me that this class is for the fellow and to deliver an easy lecture so that they can understand. Actually, just yesterday I came to know that it is on intervention. So I was thinking for fellow, interventional echo is too much advanced. So I have prepared a very easy lecture for them. And I hope this will be beneficial for them. And along with this, I will touch a little bit on intervention, but the fellows, they should learn the basic things first. And then, but I was actually not informed about all the renowned cardiologists who I am seeing in the screen now. So I am a little bit nervous with my presentation because this is not a very good one, a simple one for the fellows. So just forgive me if you don't find any interest in my class. So I'm going to my presentation now.
I need to share something.
Just a minute, I'm coming. So, respected Shafi Majumdar sir, all the panelists, madam, and all my dear colleagues and the students, I'm welcoming you all to my presentation, especially on echocardiography, as I am a congenital heart disease specialist. I will tell you something about the congenital heart disease, and then I will tell you little about the interventions in relation to this presentation. So, are you seeing my screen?
Yes, madam.
Thank you. So, whenever we start echo of any of the child or any adult patient with congenital heart disease, we have to know a few things. First of all, a fellow should know about his machine. So first thing is know your machine. What kind of machine you have? What are the probes? Which probe you have to select? Which probe you have to select for the pediatric patient, for the newborn, for the adult? And then you have to know your patient. For example, you have a very small patient. So you cannot get a good picture unless you sedate this child because he will scream. He will cry and he will not support you to get the views. So you have to sedate. So second point is know your patient and then know your task exactly. For example, you want to see whether there is any congenital heart disease. Then you have to go sequentially according to the rules of the sequential segmental analysis. Then sometime you want to only know the cardiac function. Then you can do some functional echo, or sometimes we do only functional echocardiography in the in our like neonatal ICU. So in those cases, we don't do detailed echocardiography. Those are the functional echocardiography to measure like pulmonary artery pressure, to see the cardiac function, to see whether there is any dehydration by measuring IVC diameter like this. So know your task, what you want to know. Every time we don't need to do everything. So you have to have clear idea on your task and then know how to report. After doing your analysis, you have to have a report. So if it is a report on congenital heart disease, you have to write in one way. If it is an adult heart disease, you have to write in another way. If it is on function, you have to write in another. If it is a functional echo, then you have to write on another way. So you have to know how to write a report. So these are the four important things a fellow should know before starting echocardiography. So in introduction, we can say that a successful echocardiographic examination requires not only a thorough knowledge of the spatial cardiac anatomy and congenital heart disease, but also the understanding of how best to approach the pediatric patient. So you cannot just pull a child to the bed, start doing echo. You will not get anything to approach. With all of its sophisticated instrument and technology and an unknown echocardiographer, unknown doctor and unknown staff in the cath lab and in the echo lab, echocardiography can be a frightening environment for a small child. Even for the adult people, they are also worried about all these instruments and the stuff. So it is the first thing to dispel as many as of his or her fear as possible. So child's parents should be encouraged to enter to the room. Sometimes we don't allow them. If you bring a child alone, he will cry. So he will not help you to do the examination. So their presence reassures that that this examination is not harmful for him or painful for him. Child should be introduced to the echocardiographic equipment by explaining that this equipment will be used to take some picture. It will not be used for giving saline. It will not be used to give some medicine. It will only be used to take some picture, like what his parents do or her parents do with him with camera. So it is almost like taking photographs. So about the machine, I don't want to tell that much. Wherever you are taking training under your teachers, they will show you and you will get the machine in own hospitals. So what are the facilities like? In some hospitals, there are very advanced machine like 3D, 4D. In some hospitals, there are ice probe even. So you have to know in which hospital you are working and in that hospital, what machine is available. So this is a machine in our hospital. We have 5-6 machines in our hospital. This is the best one we use for the pediatrics. And this is the Sony Acuvsat machine, Philips Acuvsat machine. And you are seeing here the probes. So these are the important, you should know about the probes. These are the various kind like 8S, 5S, 12S. This one is for the newborn and like vascular probes. So you have to attach all those probes to these points. So these are the points for connection of the probe and these are the probe. And normally all these probes remain attached with the machine. You just have to select your probe. For example, if you want to do echocardiography of a child, you should select like 7 or 8. If you want to do in the newborn, you can select 8 or 9. And for the adult, you can select 3 or 2.5. So echo machine is an artificial intelligence. I sometimes took a lecture with my student about the artificial intelligence. You have to know what is artificial intelligence. And all the machines which we use in cardiology, in the cath lab, in the echo lab, in the Holter monitor, all these are the application of the artificial intelligence. So echo machine is also an artificial intelligence. Many inputs are there inside the machine and machine will give the output according to your need. Whatever you will ask, for example, you want to do LV function. So you select an LV function. There are many types of LV functions. So whatever you like, you can select that and you will go for the LV function, for the RV function, like this. So this machine has various types of information inside. They will give you the output, whatever you want. And nowadays, these machines are so advanced that you don't need to do any calculation. Machine will do all the calculations for you. So there are some other special equipments you need to have in your echocardiography room. What is that? A hospital bed. Hospital bed we usually prefer for the examination rather than the examination table with side rail so that baby will not drop. When he starts crying, he will not listen to anybody. He will roll and then he may drop on the ground. So it is better to have side rails which will protect him when he screams. And the head of the bed, there should be the facilities that head of the bed can be raised a little bit. And the height of the bed can be adjusted. For example, if you want to do the same echocardiography machine will be used for the adult, for children. So if you want to do adult, your level should be a little bit less because body of the adult is high. So there should be facility for the adjustment of the height of the table. And then know your patient. For example, a patient is 7 years old. And if you can talk to him, if you can counsel him, he may listen to you. So there is no need for sedation. But if the child is even sometimes 7 years old child, they don't listen to us. They just cry. And it is very difficult in older children to sedate. A normal Phanergan, normal clural height, these are actually too little for them and they don't sedate with those machines. And you need to actually sedate with a strong sedative agent for the older children, but for the smaller children, we can use the light agent, even antihistaminic drugs can work. So it is essential that the child lies still during examination so that accurate diagnostic information can be obtained. And following means are used in our lab, small infants can be pacified. So we give them feeding bottle, like some pacifier, So they just sag those things and remain busy. And by that time, we finish our work. And older children, we always reward them with the toys, chocolates, like this. So they remain busy with the toys, with the chocolates, and by that time, we do our work. And commonly used drug, it is Phenergan, because, you know, Phenergan is a simple antihistaminic drug. So this one has very little side effect. Even there is no side effect, we can say, because we use Phenergan to treat side effects of the other drugs. So Phenergan is very safe for the children, and dose is 1 mg/kg body weight. And we also sometimes use syrup chloral hydrate. You know, Bangladesh government has banned this medicine. Now, if you want to use chloral hydrate, you have to bring this from the India, because they are using it, and in their market, this drug is available, and dose is 50 mg/kg. And one thing you have to remember, that in children, there is no dose, like one tablet, one teaspoonful, two teaspoonful, like adult. Every time you have to calculate the dose according to the body weight. So for a 5 kg, Phenergan dose is 5 mg. So one teaspoonful is 5 mg. For a 20 kg, dose is 20 mg. It is not like adult, that one ampoule or one tablet. So I always see that the people don't take any weight, and they give the medicines haphazardly without calculating the proper dose. So it does not work. And then injection diazepam, we can give paranasally. You know that there is mucous membrane inside the nose and also in the rectum. So if we give this drug pararectally or paranasally, it actually immediately absorbs. Within 10 minutes, it starts work. So it is a very good medicine, injection diazepam, and very safe. There will be no respiratory depression if it absorbs through mucous membrane. But if you give it IV, patient may go to respiratory arrest immediately. So you will be in trouble. So never give diazepam IV without having assistance like ambubec and resuscitation equipment. Injection ketamine also. If you give ketamine without having any resuscitation facilities, patient will go to arrest and patient may die. There are many evidence that patient died. And this kind of inhibition, respiratory center inhibition by these drugs are very transient. If you can manage them for 1 or 2 minutes, the patient will come back automatically. But if you cannot manage in this 1 to 2 golden minutes, then patient will die. And safely you can use diazepam suppository also. So the use of any sedative agent in the children requires the presence of specially trained nursing personnel to closely monitor the child. Nothing happened in most of the time. In 99.9% cases, nothing happened. But in 0.1% case, something may happen and you have to resuscitate at that time. Otherwise, patient will die. So there are some special situations also. We perform the following echocardiographic procedure in cath lab. So some of the echocardiography we perform in the cath lab with full precaution. What are those? Echo with ketamine anesthesia. So we are giving echo. So ketamine is like a general anesthetic agent. So those who are not used with using ketamine, they should not do it without an expert one. We use ketamine like anything. So because we are very much expert in these things, and nothing happened because we know how to deal with the complications. Then transesophageal echocardiography. You know, transesophageal echocardiography in children should be done under general anesthesia. So when we do any transesophageal echocardiography, we send the list with the cath list to the cath lab, and we do with the cath lab under coverage of the anesthetist and in the cath lab with proper support of all kind of resuscitation. And actually, T is not that much required in the children because their window is very good. Why to do these invasive things? Why to go for the general anesthesia? So we don't do very little. We actually, percentage of transesophageal echo is very minimum in our setup. So this is our echo lab. You are seeing that the mother is playing with the child and sister is also playing with the child. And echocardiographer, he is doing his job. So. And here you see the pararectal diazepam. Sister is giving pararectal diazepam to the child for sedation. And in other side, you are seeing toys. So you have to decorate your pediatric echo lab with the toys. And here drugs. One of our staff is giving medicine orally. And after that, you have to know what are the views. So I think all of you know by now what are the views. So I'll go through these things quickly. And these are the views you see by this arrow you are seeing here. 1, 2, 3, 4. Where is the cursor? So these 1, 2, 3, 4. These are the actually place for placing the probe of the echo machine. So in the first place, these are the parasternum. So this is side of the sternum. So this is parasternal long axis. You have to point your pointer of the probe towards this side and pointer of the probe to that side. So this side pointer will give long axis and that side will be short axis. And here is the apical fourth chamber. Then here is the in the below the, you know, the sternum will be subcostal views. And these are the photographs. I'll later show you good photographs. So if we see the anatomy of the heart, you can see here that this is the long axis. So after that, we'll show you what are the structures. So you see, this is the RV outflow tract. This is the left ventricle. This is the mitral valve apparatus. And this is the mitral valve leaflets. And this is the left atrium. This is the aorta. This is the aortic valve. So this is whole, most of the part of the heart you can see by that. And this is the interventricular septum. And this is the anterior wall of the heart. This is the posterior wall of the heart. So you can see most of the things in long axis view. And this is a short axis view. We are seeing that this is the LV, and we always measure our LV function from this kind of ketchup. And this is the apical fourth chamber. You are seeing how it looks. Two atrium with the interatrial septum, two ventricle with the interventricular septum. Then here is the tricuspid valve, and here is the mitral valve. Again, this is also a kind of fourth chamber view. So in parasternal short axis, we can see many structure of the heart. So when you will study from your book, you will see that what are the structure we can see. Most importantly, aortic valve, you can say whether it is a tricuspid valve or bicuspid valve, you can say very nicely from this view. Then you can see RV outflow tract, left atrium. From the parasternal long axis, I have shown you already all the left-sided structure of the heart. You can see clearly from the parasternal long axis. So what are the left-sided structure? Left atrium, left ventricle, aortic valve, aorta, root of the aorta. So you will be able to see above, and with this, you will be able to see also the interventricular septum. And from the apical fourth chamber, I have already shown you, but you have to know what are the chambers, because you will be asked in your exam that what are the structure you will be able to see from the apical fourth chamber view. And then subcostal is a series. So you can sweep anterior posteriorly, you can sweep laterally to a medial to lateral. So in those sweeps, many structures come, and when you will see practically, we'll see that many structure we can see from the subcostal, and you are seeing the list of those. So right to left sweep, you can see like inferior vena cava, superior vena cava. This is very good view, especially for ASD device closure procedure. You can see both the cava together, and you can see the rims of the inferior vena cava, which is very important for the ASD device closure. And in suprasternal view, you can see the aorta and right pulmonary artery. And this is a very good view for diagnosing coarctation of aorta. And you always, in pediatric practice, you should do this suprasternal view at the end of all view. Because when you put your probe in the suprasternal region, baby will cry. So don't do this before completing all other things. So this is the last one, because when you will put, the baby will wake up and then start crying. So this is the last one, and this is important. Never finish your echocardiography. I often see that people are missing coarctation of aorta because they don't do this. Never miss this, because in this view only you can see the coarctation of aorta and even interrupted aortic arch, then like aneurysm of the ascending aorta. These kind of things you will be able to see from this view. And there are suprasternal short axis. This is a very good view for visualizing four pulmonary veins together. You will not see four pulmonary veins in other views. In parasternal long axis, you will see three, but for the four, you will see in this view. and this is a very good view for diagnosing even anomalous pulmonary venous drainage. So you have to know what is your task, whether you are doing an adult echocardiography to see the regional wall motion, to see whether ischemia is involved, which part, or like cardiomyopathy, or for other adult issues. But for the pediatric, your issue is to look for a congenital heart disease, sometime for the coronary arteries to look for the Kawasaki disease, sometime for the L-kappa. You know that there are many coronary artery abnormalities which can happen to children also. It is not only the sole property of the adult. It is sometime the property of the children because they have anomalous origin of coronary artery sometime from the pulmonary artery. That is a very bad situation. And what happened, this is known as L-kappa. So sometimes you see we are writing L-kappa, you don't understand. And L-kappa is the anomalous origin of left coronary artery from the pulmonary artery. And in those situations, what happened? All the blood from the coronary territory are drained into the pulmonary territory because pulmonary pressure is less, coronary pressure is high. So there is left to right shunt. And then the patient develops ischemia. So L-kappa is a kind of ischemic heart disease where patient develops ischemic cardiomyopathy. So you will see the patient will present as cardiomyopathy, but this is actually from the L-kappa. So whenever you find cardiomyopathy in a child, please, please look for the L-kappa because there is some reason. Sometimes most of the cases, these are viral, post-viral. For example, in COVID-19, we are getting cardiomyopathy, but you have to see also the rare cause. You have to look. You are an echocardiographer. You have to look all the causes. By seeing the DCM, you can't say whether it is a viral. Sometimes we can say whether it is a myocarditis, whether it is from the myocarditis, whether it is derived from the myocarditis. In those cases, we do some investigation like for the myocarditis, we do the cardiac enzymes. So you have to correlate everything. So in sequential diagnosis of the heart, we always consider the heart as a house. So you are seeing here a house where there are three stories. The first one in the base, this is a very good technique to learn congenital echoes. So this is the base of the house, which is atrium. So there are two atrium, right and left. So this is a two-sided. And then this is the second floor, which is ventricle. And this is the third floor, which are great vessels. So on the left side is the aorta and then the pulmonary artery on the other side. And you are seeing the stair. So what are these stairs? This is atrioventricular connection, which is what? Which is tricuspid valve and mitral valve. And this is ventriculo-arterial connection. What is it? It is aortic valve and mitral valve. So if we consider heart as a house, you will never miss anything. You will start from the ground floor. You will see both the atrium and its connection with the ventricle. Then you will see both the ventricle and its connection with the aorta or pulmonary artery. Then you go to the aorta and pulmonary artery and you will see whether these are normal or not. Remember one thing. If there is anything abnormal, that will be reflected in the chamber of the heart, these houses. So, for example, if somebody has ASD, that will be reflected in the chamber of the heart by enlargement of the right side of the heart. So, if you see enlargement of the right side of the heart, you have to look subsequently for the causes of the right-sided enlargement. If you see left-sided enlargement, you have to go for the cause of left-sided enlargement. In this way, you will be able to pick up all the diseases. So, you should know all the theoretical things, what are the cause of right side, what are the volume overload, pressure overload, left side, volume overload, pressure overload, aorta, what are the causes of aortic disease, and then pulmonary disease, and you will be able, these will be very easy. Echocardiography is very easy if you have all the knowledge in the back of your mind. So now you are seeing there's these three segments of the heart. This is the segmental approach. So first segment, second segment, and the third segment. So if we cut the heart like this, this is the first segment, this is second segment, this is third segment, and we have to see whether all these things are okay. Now, what will be the problem? Problem is that the right side of the atrium, like right atrium, may be on the left side, left atrium may be on the right side. So there may be atrial situs inversus. So you have to know how to identify each structure. What are the landmark of the right atrium? What are the landmark of the left atrium? It may happen in the adult also. Sometimes I find many cases of adult with correct transposition of great arteries. These are missed for long time because adult people, they actually are acquainted with their findings, their things. So in back of their mind, they always deal with their own problems. They don't think about the congenital problems. So most of the time, they actually don't look for this. They thought it is now. But there are many example is this one. Now, so it is helpful to consider the heart as a atrium. Now you understand. Heart can also, and then what will be your segmental structure. So first of all, we know that in the heart, there are many abnormalities, like there is situs inversus, there is leukocardia. There is tachycardia. So it is or situs inversus. So why congenital heart disease is a little bit difficult? Because you have to see the other organs of the body also. For example, if you have situs inversus, so if the heart is a dextrocardia and there is situs inversus, then it is a different situation. It is situs inversus totalis, and you have to look for other. And then if it is only a dextrocardia with situs solitus, that is a different situation. So as a pediatric echocardiographer, it is your responsibility to declare whether this is a levocardia, whether this is a mesocardia, whether this is a dextrocardia. So first of all, you have to inform everyone about your stand on whether it is a situs solitus. And then you have to see the apex, whether the apex of the heart is in the left side or in the middle or in the right side. Then atrial situs, you have to see whether it is a atrial situs. One thing is universal truth, you have to remember that atrial situs always goes with the body situs. So if atrial situs is inversus, body situs will be also situs inversus. So you will get the liver on the left side, you will get the stomach on the right side like this. So, and aortic arch is also with the body situs. So aortic arch will be on the right side. So it is one universal truth for the echocardiographer. Then atrioventricular connection, you have to look whether the tricuspid valve is in the right side. Sometimes tricuspid valve is on the left side of the heart. So that is a ventricular inversion. So whether there is any ventricular inversion, you have to start from the position of your valve. So how will you recognize this is a tricuspid valve? We will see in the photograph later on. And then you have to identify which ventricle is right ventricle, which ventricle is left ventricle, because you will not get right ventricle in the right side in 100% cases. In some of the cases, right ventricle will be right side or right ventricle in the left side. We know that conus is a property of right ventricle, but sometimes it can go to the left side. So you have to see it is a space below the valve actually, which connects the region of the ventricle with the great vessel. So this space should be identified. And then ventricular arterial connection. And then that one not coming. So in another way, we can analyze our heart. So far, I was telling about the segmental analysis or house-like analysis. Now I am telling another type so that you will miss nothing. What is that? You can analyze heart according to the direction of the blood flow. So systemic and pulmonary veins, blood flows are coming inside the atrium. So you see first that systemic venous connection, pulmonary venous connection, then you come to the atrium. Then you come to the atrioventricular valve. So according to the flow of the blood, you can also analyze your heart. So here you are seeing the flow, blood flow with the arrows. So this is the superior vena cava, inferior vena cava. So you identify superior vena cava, inferior vena cava, then flow towards the tricuspid valve. So you identify right atria. Now you are happy that the these two vernacular are connected with the right atrium, which is normal. If you don't see this, sometimes you'll see that IVC is interrupted. It is a very common finding in complex congenital heart disease. So you have to ensure whether IVC is here or not. And then sometimes there is a zygous continuation. There is no inferior vena cava. And developmentally, it continues up to the superior vena cava from towards the back of the heart as a zygous vein. So you have to declare whether there is a zygous vein continuation or there is so inferior vena cava. Then you come to the tricuspid valve and you identify whether it is tricuspid valve. So one thing important is that tricuspid valve is apical ward attachment. So you will see that the attachment of the septal leaflet will be a little bit downward than the attachment of the mitral valve, which we will show you later. And according to the flow, you from the tricuspid valve, you will come to the right ventricle. You will see that this is a trabeculated one and this is a smooth walled one. So in this picture, even you are seeing that this is a smooth wall, this is trabeculated. And from this, you will go to the pulmonary valve. You will see whether there is any problem here. Then you will go to the pulmonary artery. You will see whether there is any problem. You can measure pulmonary artery systolic and diastolic pressure if it is required. Then you go to the branch pulmonary arteries. You will see whether there is any stenosis. Up to this part may be normal, but there may be problem in the distal part, peripheral pulmonary artery stenosis. So you have to look for those peripheral parts also. Here in this part, maybe at aortopulmonary window, in this part, maybe patent ductus arteriosus, but you will not that much understand on the pulmonary side. You will get a flow here, but from this side, later on, you will see the PDA clearly. And then the blood will go to the lungs now from here. So after the lungs, it will come to the pulmonary veins. So you will see whether the pulmonary venous connection. So according to the direction of the blood flow, you will come to the pulmonary vein, you will come to the left atrium, then you will come to the mitral valve, then you will come to the left ventricle, then you will come to the aortic valve, then you will come to the aorta, you will check ascending aorta, whether everything is okay, whether there is any dilatation, any stenosis, any supra-aortic stenosis here, which is missed because we don't see all these things. And then you will come through this way, and then you come here, and then here you will see that if there is any coarctation, you will see here, and PDA will be visualized very nicely from this situation. And neck vessel, you will be able to see from here. And from this side, sometime you will see persistent left SVC, which will come directly from here to the right atrium like this. So after finishing all this, you can look for the persistent left SVC also. And then you can go to the abdomen to see the descending aorta if you want to see. So step one is the thoracoabdominal situs solitus or situs inversus and visceral sidedness. And if you see any proper echocardiographer pediatric, you'll see that they first place their probe on the abdomen. And they see whether these two structures are normal. So this is the aorta on the left side. This is the spine. So you'll first find your anatomical landmark, the spine, vertebra. And then you will see that aorta is on the this side, IVC on the right side. And how will you identify whether this is aorta, whether this is IVC? You will see this is the pulsatile structure. You will see the pulse. And then if you put your CW, you will get a continuous wave Doppler of the arterial flow. And if you put your continuous wave here, you will see the venous flow. So by this way, you can be sure that these are the aorta and inferior vena cava. And then you will follow the inferior vena cava to see whether it is going into the right atrium or not, to see whether there is interrupted IVC or a zygous continuation. And then if it is a situs solitus, you will see like this. So in situs solitus structure, this is the right bronchus, which is like vertical course, and this is like little bit upward. So this one is the left with the vertical, and this was in the right. It is short, and it is if any foreign body enter into the airway, it straight away go to the right lung soloist because this course is very easy. But here, course is little bit like horizontal, so foreign body easily go to these lungs. This is a side talk I am telling. So in the right lobe, there are three lobes, and left two lobes. Why I am telling this? Because you will sometimes we are telling isomerism. So in that case, what happened? If it is left isomerism, left lobe will be on both sides. Both bronchus will be like this. If it is a right isomerism, then this thing will be there also. So there is duplication. of right sided structure and bronchus and everything they will duplicate. So you have to know also about the isomerism, because isomerism is related with the complex heart disease. And then if you come to the situs ambiguus, you will not see this liver, which one is right lobe, which one is left lobe, you don't know. And here you know this is the right and this is the left. But this is a dextrocardia, but still it is a situs solitus. But here it is a levocardia and it is a situs ambiguus. And this is right isomerism. So these are very complex things, but easy. If you think judiciously, if you think nicely, these are very easy things. So cardiac position like apex, maybe left, right, middle. So if it is a mirror image dextrocardia, you have to place the probe in mirror image position on this side of the chest. So precordium is this one, not this one. So this is the precordium in right-sided heart. And you have to place your probe long axis view towards this, short axis view towards this. So this is just the reverse of the probe position in this precordium. So this is right precordium, this is left precordium. When there is dextrocardia, you have to study on the right precordium and you have to place your ECG probe also accordingly. So if you do the ECG on this side, placing all the chest lead like this, you will not get anything because you will go away from the heart and your recording will be very, trace will be very low voltage. So after that, here is a dextrocardia heart. See, if you correct the position of the probe, your image will be like the left-sided heart because you have corrected your probe. So you will see everything in a normal way. Various types of congenital heart disease, you are the fellows, you don't need to know all the problematic cases. You just need to know the simple things. So, and Shafi Majumdar sir, he told me to not to confuse you and to tell you in simple way. So in simple way, you have to go for the straight way to the atrial septation. Atrial septation, we know that in between two atrium, there is interatrial septum. In interatrial septum, what are the problems which may happen? So you have to know the applied anatomy of the heart. In the atrial septum, you have a hole. You may have a hole. So what this hole is? One kind of hole is ASD, another kind of hole is PFO or patent foramen ovale. What is the difference in the echocardiography in PFO and the ASD? ASD, you will see the T sign. These are two like equal lines above and below the hole. But in the PFO, this is a tunnel. So you will see that septum primum and septum secondum, they will overlap each other. And in between this overlapping, PFO will be like this. So just look at my hand, like this, a tunnel. But ASD is like this. So you will get two ends, but in PFO, it will be like this. So these two kinds of hole may happen in the heart, and you have to differentiate, and ASD, you have to differentiate whether it is a sinus venosus, whether it is a secondum, whether it is a primum. And in the ventricle, also ventricular septal defect, there are so many kind of ventricular septal defect. And you are the echocardiographer. You have to know because you have to write your report, whether it is a doubly committed, whether it is a subaortic, whether it is a perimembranous, whether it is a muscular, whether it is an inlet. So an echocardiographer need to be master of all. And then atrioventricular septal defect, this is a separate entity of the Cushion defect. So if there is any defect in the Cushion, you will get some other kind. And then you can see truncus arteriosus. In this case, there is some of the congenital heart disease are always associated with male aligned kind of VSD. Just memorize these things from today. These are tetralogy of Fallot, pulmonary atresia with VSD, truncus arteriosus. These three kind of disease always associated with male aligned VSD because they need to drain both the ventricle. Right ventricle has no outlet, left ventricle and has no separate outlet. So in these three situations, you will get male aligned VSD. So in truncus arteriosus, you will get male aligned VSD. So here is a diagrammatic picture for your understanding. So this is the ASD. And after atrium, as I said, you have to come to tricuspid valve. So here you are seeing the tricuspid valve is absent. So this is a tricuspid atresia. And then this is the right ventricle and this is the VSD. As tricuspid valve is absent, blood is not coming from here to here. So this child will die if there is no chance of blood to come here, because pulmonary artery is here. He needs some blood to keep the baby alive. So how this patient remain alive, you have to explain. So if you just write the report, the tricuspid atresia, that is nothing. That will be a rubbish to the cardiac surgeon, because how you are telling a tricuspid atresia patient is alive without telling the mechanism how he is alive. So in this child, he is alive by means of this ASD and by means of this BSD. So his blood is diverting like this, he is going there. So in this situation, there are some situations where life is not possible unless there is some other way. So in tricuspid atresia, this is one situation where there is some way, and Allah is so kind, he has given all the child some ways or other for survival. So ventricular hypoplasia is another. As we are dealing with ventricle, we can see that some, for example, in tricuspid atresia, if there is no blood inflow to the right ventricle will be hypoplastic. In this way, ekta nodite jodi pani na jay, shei nodita to shukaye jay, more jay. Thik sherokom heart er kono jaygay jodi blood na jete pare, shei jaygata shukiye jay. Eitai hocche hypoplasia theory. Hypoplasia ta emni hoy na. Disease theke hote pare othoba lack of flow theke hote pare in case of heart. And tarpore amra ashi abnormalities of the ventricular outflow. Amra etokkhon inflow dekhlam, aro inflow amra dekhbo. Ekhon amra dekhchi je outflow. Ekta outflow, one of the outflow is here is the pulmonary bulb, so there might be pulmonary stenosis, aortic stenosis like this. And in the ventricular arterial connection, there may be TGA. TGA is the transposition, so red vessel may exchange their position between them. Both of the red vessel may be from the right ventricle or from the left ventricle. So this is here as TGA. You are seeing that aorta changed its position with the pulmonary artery and pulmonary artery with the aorta. And you will be able to identify this in the echocardiography very nicely. And I think after this lecture, you will be able to understand that. And there are some abnormalities in the vascular connection. Easy one is that here you are seeing that this is a vertical vein which is draining all four pulmonary veins to it. So pulmonary veins are not coming to the left atrium. With the help of vertical veins, they are draining into the left, this kind of the innominate vein here. And then it is coming to the superior vena cava, and then it is coming to the right atrium. So this is a supracardiac type of TAPBC. So this is the abnormalities in the vascular connection. And in the chamber, you may see cardiomyopathy and neoplasm. So after doing all these things, you have to know how to write the pediatric echo report. You have to describe the chapters which I have mentioned already. You have to describe, for example, ASD. You have to write, this is a second num ASD, 10 millimeter in size, left to right shunt or right to left shunt, non-restrictive or restrictive. Then you have to measure the rims, superior rim, inferior rim, and then length of the total IS. Then as ASD is always sometimes associated with other disease like mitral valve abnormalities, like anomalous pulmonary venous draining. So you have to mention the other associations also. And then measurement of the cardiac chambers and vessels. For ASD, we'll get right-sided volume overload. So you have to mention about that. LV will be like D-shaped, so you have to mention about that. Then evaluation of the valves and gradient from the tricuspid regurgitation. In these kind of cases, you have to measure the pulmonary artery pressure, because ASD is a cause of, for example, I am telling you ASD. So ASD is a cause of pulmonary hypertension, but pulmonary hypertension is not that much bad in ASD, unless in some rare cases. So you have to mention whether there is pulmonary hypertension or not from the TR gradient. Then evaluation of the function. Sometimes ASD may cause right-sided heart failure. So you have to mention about the heart functions. Then wall motion abnormalities. In this kind of in ASD defect, there is abnormalities of the motion of the interventricular septum. There is paradoxical motion. So you have to mention that. And in the conclusion, you will write only the gist. So in summary, you will write, this is an ASD second num, mild TR, mild pulmonary hypertension. Like this, and then you can give your recommendation. If it is a too large ASD, you can write that ASD surgical closure. If it is a divisible, you can say ASD device closure. So in conclusion, the study of the heart by ultrasound, first introduced in 1952, and gradually added and refined to has become the most important diagnostic investigation in pediatric cardiology. I can mention you here that it is almost 100% sensitive and specific, almost. So you don't need to do actually cardiac catheterization nowadays for diagnostic purpose. Only for a few complex cases we do, but mainly we do cardiac catheterization nowadays for the interventional purpose. And the technique is painless and safe, and therefore it can be repeated. There is no hazard of radiation and sound wave hazard. Actually, sound wave has no hazard. So it can be repeated multiple times, whatever time. So it is like a clinical stethoscope now. It is a part of clinical examination. Every time we want to check something, we can do echo immediately. And we have portable machine. It can do multiple times in the bedside. So therefore, it can be repeated as often as required to follow the changes in a child's heart and to monitor the effect of medical and surgical treatment. For example, today you have done an echo and found ASD of 10 millimeter. After 3 months, you will find ASD of 14 millimeter. After 1 year, you will find 16 millimeter. Or reverse may happen, it will reduce. But reverse happen only up to 1 year and maximally up to 2 years. After that, no ASD will close. And rather, ASD become very large. So if a child is having ASD of 5 millimeter, and if he come to you at the age of 30 years later, you will see that the ASD is 25 millimeter, 30 millimeter. So it is always better to screen these cases from the very beginning. And even if you need to close them with the device, you can close with a 10 millimeter, 12 millimeter, 16 millimeter device. But if you keep them alone, then you need to close them with the 36 millimeter. And larger device has more complication. So the aim of the echocardiography is to determine the anatomy of the heart, assess the function of all the components of the heart, detecting abnormal features of the heart, to look at the normal flow through valves and tracts or abnormal flow or stents. A dedicated and experienced echocardiographer can provide diagnostic and follow-up service. You need to give follow-up also after device, after surgery. You have to see whether everything is fine or not. So you have to give follow-up service also to the patient up to the mark if surrogate priority. Sometimes we prefer money, but money is a byproduct. If you are a very good physician, if you are a very good cardiologist, if you are a very good something, anything, money will run behind you and that will be a byproduct. So first thing is to qualify yourself as the best physician, best cardiologist, best doctor of the country. So this is up to my lecture, sir, and I have some photographs. If I have time, I'll show you later. Sir, up to you, sir.
Dr. Monohar.
Thank you, madam. I think we can have some photographs from madam.
Right, madam
is wishing.
I think right now we can show, yeah.
If you have time, because you have another lecture. Actually, I want to talk. Actually, I love talking, but the thing is, the time is limited.
No, I think it is a very good talk, brief and simple, and I like it. It is too much.
Thank you, sir. I
always expect a very simple talk, not the complicated.
That's why, sir. According to your instructions, sir, I am preparing. I am talking like this so that our fellow they can understand.
Yeah.
So these are the positions of various probes of the dextrocardia. They will learn levocardia from everyone. So just I am showing that what is the position.
Yeah.
And this is the levocardia position of the heart. You are seeing that, sir. This is the right side. Here is the apex. So apex of the heart is on the right side. Now, fetal cardiology, I don't want to tell because it is too much for you. But this is a mode of echocardiography. You just remember. So, see, here is a fetus. You are seeing a fetus. So, whenever you will go for the fetal echocardiography, you have to bring this view first. And then this is the spine. So, if we see the spine, we understand that heart is in front of it. So, for other people here who are experienced person here, we can get the heart. Here is the heart. So, if you get this, you can see the heart just in front of it. And here is the heart. So, this is the chest wall of the baby. Chest. And this is the heart. And then transesophageal, we don't do, as I have mentioned earlier, and you need to do general anesthesia. So we don't want that much of the invasive things for our small child. And indication is also very minimum. And we actually One of my article has been published recently, minimalistic approach of HD device closure. We never use tea for doing HD device closure, even in adult. So we can do by giving less pain to the patient. And then I'm going to the photo now. So this is the IBC. This is a collapsing structure. If you see, you will see that this is collapse structure. So you will understand. And if you put your PW or CW here, you will get a low venous flow. And here you will get pulsatile, high velocity arterial flow. So contrast echo is another type of echo. We can do it for the PFO. You know, sir, for the adult population, PFO is a very important structure for the adult people. Many of our adult population, they have PFO, but we don't know because normal echocardiography cannot detect it. You have to do by this TCD or transcarotid Doppler mechanism, or by coughing, or by raising Valsalva maneuver, or by otherwise you will not see the right to left shunt through the PFO. And if there is any right to left shunt in PFO, there is chance of stroke. So if any person has stroke, they should be evaluated thoroughly for the presence of PFO. Because if you close the PFO, it is very simple. Then there will be no stroke in future. So indication of doing thorough echocardiography and TCD for looking PFO is a history of stroke once in a person. So I think neurology people, they can refer their cases to cardiologists for this purpose. Now we are seeing here some of the photographs. This is the short axis view of the aorta. This is the long axis view of the pulmonary artery. So you remember always that these two vessels will never come in same axis. One, if one come in short axis, another will come in long axis. But if you get both in same axis, both in long axis, both in short axis, that is transposition of great artery. So very simple clue to identify TGA is both of them will never come in same axis. So here you are seeing this is the normal short axis aorta, long axis pulmonary. And this is the patent ductus arteriosus red one. So in this view, you can see PDA. And this is the third thumb. This is one finger. I'm going here again just to understand you. This is one finger. You can see the three finger here. This is one finger. This is one finger. And this is another finger. So if you see three finger like shadow here, this is a PDA. Third finger is PDA. Here there is no finger, only two finger. And this is a very good view of the arch of the aorta. So you have to bring the arch of the aorta here. You will see coarctation in some of the position from here to here, and you will see PDA here. So this is the position of the PDA just at the commencement of the descending aorta. And here is the PDA again. And this is an ASD here you are seeing. This is the ASD here, and this is the tricuspid atrius here. So one thing for your information I'm telling, if there is a tricuspid atrius here, and if there is an ASD, then patient will only survive in tricuspid atresia if there is ASD. So you must have to mention about the ASD, and you must have to mention about shunt. So some people, they write in the report that there is an ASD in tricuspid atresia with left to right shunt. So that is what? This is nothing. Because left to right shunt is never possible in ASD with tricuspid atresia. It is always right to left shunt. So my dear fellows, you just learn basic things. You write this report in this way, and we always find the report like this. So right to left shunt, you are seeing the color here. This is blue. This blood is going away from the transducer. So those blood will go towards the transducer. This is the transducer position. So the blood which will go towards this will be red, and away from this will be right. It's like blue. So this is away from the transducer. This is the ASD of the tricuspid atresia. And this is the universal truth that ASD is always right to left shunt with tricuspid atresia. So you are seeing that this is a tricuspid atresia, very large ASD. So his life is saved. He is a very large, having very large ASD, so he will not die unless there is some other problem in other place. So if I see like this, I will be actually, I will be happy that this patient don't need anything emergency. So this is the tricuspid atresia, and you see right ventricle is very small, and this is the single ventricle type. And there is ASD and pulmonary veins, two here you are seeing and one is here. So I said in this view, you can see three pulmonary veins. So this is again the same, and this patient is very lucky. He has also pulmonary stenosis. So his pulmonary circulation is also saved. This is what? You are seeing that this is the atrial septum part, this is the ventricular septum, and this is the atrioventricular valve. There is no separate tricuspid, there is no separate mitral, and this is a common valve, and there is a common defect. So this is a AV canal defect. I think from next time you will be able to diagnose this. You are seeing again here this common AV canal, common AV valve. This is again here, this is again. So this is another case where you are seeing that there is flow of blood towards the transducer. This is the left ventricle, this is aorta, and this is the right ventricle, this is the interventricular septum, and blood is flowing towards the transducer. So this is a left ventricle to right ventricle shunt, because this one is right ventricle, blood is going towards the right ventricle. So this is a left to right shunt in BSD. This is a perimembranous location, large perimembranous. But what is with this, from this view, we will not see. You are seeing here that this is a DRV with tossing wing anomaly. So this is a complex one, but you just learn for the time being that this is a VSD with left to right shunt. Now you are seeing here that this same VSD, when I tilt the transducer, this is now this. So by seeing only one tilt, by seeing only one position, you should not write your report. থলির বিড়াল আস্তে আস্তে বের হবে, প্রথমে কিন্তু বের হবে না। সো আমি যখন প্রথমে দেখছি তখন ওইরকম ছিল, ওটা দেখে রিপোর্ট দিলে কিন্তু ভুল হয়ে যেত। নাও আই এম প্রসিডিং, আই এম সিইং দ্যাট ইট ইজ এ সাব পালমোনারি, দিস ওয়ান ইজ সাব পালমোনারি, দিস ইজ পালমোনারি ভাল অ্যান্ড দিস ইজ লেফট ভেন্ট্রিকল। সো দি অ্যান্ড সাম অফ দিস পালমোনারি আর্টারি ইজ অলসো কমিটেড টুয়ার্ডস দ্য রাইট ভেন্ট্রিকল। ইফ আই সি মোর আই উইল সি দ্যাট দিস ইজ কানেক্টেড টু রাইট ভেন্ট্রিকল অলসো। So this is a, ultimately we landed with the double outlet right ventricle, and then we found that this is a subpulmonary VSD. And if the double outlet ventricle goes with subpulmonary VSD, name of that condition is tossing wing anomaly. From today, you remember this name, tossing wing anomaly is a type of double outlet right ventricle with TGA anatomy. Double outlet with TGA anatomy. Pulmonary is mainly committed to the left ventricle. Here you are seeing that pulmonary is so much dilated. You are seeing aorta. This aorta is to the right ventricle. This side is for the right ventricle. So aorta to the right ventricle, pulmonary to the left ventricle. And it is dilated because of the too much blood flow to the pulmonary artery. After many tilt, we are getting like this. So only one tilt is not enough. You have to see thoroughly. So this is a VSD. Now this color is right. This is the left ventricle. This is the right ventricle. Now the same shunt, but here color is right. So blood is not going towards our transducer. Blood is going from here to here, away from the transducer. So this is a right to left shunt. So this kind of VSD happens with Eisenmenger syndrome. So you have to look more and more to get the pulmonary artery pressure and other things. So this is also a VSD with left to right shunt. Here is a TGA. We are seeing that this is left ventricle and pulmonary artery. This is right ventricle and aorta. And in between there is a connection. Just I want to mention one thing. Only TGA, change of vessel position. This patient cannot survive. They must have either ASD or VSD or PDA. These three, otherwise no pure blood will enter into the body. All impure blood will go to the body, and they may be survive for 1 or 2 minutes, then there will be deoxygenation and die. So you have to remember these things also. Here is interrupted aortic arch. This is the aortic arch. There is too much turbulence, and after this part there is nothing. So this is the interrupted aortic arch. And this is a very small VSD. As you are young fellows, you have to diagnose these things first by your own. So you just think about what will be your first independent echo when you will be a specialist. So this kind of echo you will be able to report independently without help of your consultant, without help of your teacher. So this is the same. I am showing you several times so that that will be, the photo will be in your mind permanently. See this interrupted aortic arch. How beautiful. This is the arch and there is nothing below this. So this is the short axis book picture. This is left atrium. This short axis view is very good one to diagnose how much cusp is there in the aortic valve. Then you can see tricuspid valve. You can see tricuspid, you can see pulmonary here. So this is the RB, this is the RA, tricuspid valve, pulmonary valve, and left atrium. And then here is the atrial septum. You can see here is an ASD. So left atrium, right atrium, tricuspid valve. So this view is very good to analyze most of the part of the heart. Even aortic valve, pulmonary valve, you can see together in this view. This is another kind of BSD with the right to left shunt. So by now you understand this is a right to left shunt because its color is here. This is a very beautiful photograph. We were seeing from subcostal view, left ventricle, right ventricle, pulmonary artery in whole aorta. So sometimes there is abdominal coarctation of aorta. You can get from here, abdominal coarctation, thoracic aorta coarctation. So in small babies, we can bring the views like this. But in adult or older children, you will not get these views. So this is a double aorta and pulmonary artery. So what is it? It is a transposition. So both vessel are in the short axis view, which should not be in normal situation. So this is a transposition of great arteries. And what is this? This I have shown you that the short axis view where we measure the LV function. And then here we are seeing something black color. So water comes black. Blood comes black in the in echocardiography 2D or even in the color Doppler. So this one is the fluid collection, maybe blood collection, maybe it is a pericardial effusion, maybe hemopericardium. But for the time being, we are saying that there is some fluid collection and most probably this is a pericardial effusion. In this case was a case of severe coarctation of aorta and newborn baby. And then we find out that this is a coarctation and then we did the balloon dilatation. And this is the mitral valve from the 3D. You know that there are 3D, 4D. And 4D is nothing but 3D with the real time. And this is the mitral valve, which is the business of the adult mainly. And here is the... You have seen that we often measure pulmonary artery. So you have to measure pulmonary artery diameter from here. Another thing you have to measure pulmonary valve and aortic valve diameter in the systole of the heart. And you have to measure tricuspid valve and mitral valve in diastole of the heart. So just remember this thing for your whole life. Measure tricuspid and mitral valve annulus from in diastole and measure aortic valve and pulmonary valve annulus in systole. This is one of my patients from the intervention echo. See, this is the echo probe. And we are doing the transthoracic echo. I never allow general anesthesia for the echo purpose unless I am undone. So this is the echo and this is, I am doing this in this guide. This is a perimembranous BSD and already done. So this is not echo picture from the cath lab, but you can see this device. This is an MA4 device, multifunctional occluder. And this is DORB tosic beam, I have mentioned, tricuspid, I have mentioned. So some of the easy things I have mentioned. So that's all, sir, from my side. Thank you for patient hearing.
Thank you. Brigadier Narunar. And the question answers, Dr. Manohar. Are there any comments from the panelists?
I like to invite Professor Rajya Surdana, madam, to make comments on madam's presentation. Madam, please.
Thank you very much. Dr. Brigadier General Narunar Fatima, she is known to everybody. She is a very highlighted and very renowned pediatric cardiologist. Thank her for her well-described and graphic presentation of today's lecture. For everybody, for us, including the students and the postgraduate fellows, it is a very good learning lesson. We can, from step by step, she said all the things from 2D echocardiography and the sections and the probes where you put it, the parasternal view, the short axis, everything was explained in detail. Then she spoke about the presentation pattern where you take the measurements and the anomalies we find in different ages according to the chambers, the ventricles, and the great arteries, and all the relationships. She had a very good, well-explained, detailed presentation. Thank you, Dr. Nurul Nahar.
Thank you, madam. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, madam.
We have got some questions and also appreciation from many of the participants. Among the questions, Dr. Raqibul Hassan wants to know the position of probe in patient with mesocardia and dextrocardia during parasternal long axis and short axis views. Madam, please.
Thank you. In mesocardia, actually, patient heart is in the middle position, and you have to see which position is best for you. There is no hard and fast rule. It is your decision. If you find, most of the time I find for me, the subcostal is comfortable for me. But some of the patient people, they also do from the right side. Even mesocardia, the heart is just in the middle. Some part is on the right side, some part is on the left side. So you can get the views even from the left side. And in children, good thing is that their bones are not so thick. So you can get good views even from the precordium, but little bit towards the right side, not truly on the left side. And your probe, the pointer. Pointer in mesocardia is like that of the levocardia. It is towards the right shoulder, left shoulder for the long axis and short axis. Thank you.
Thank you, madam. Again, from Dr. Raqibul Hassan, he wants to know, sometimes interatrial septum or interventricular septum seems to have luminal flows without turbulence. How will we overcome to confusion about true shunt from false interpretation? I think not luminal flow, the flow across the interatrial septum or interventricular septum, there may be some impression. He wants to know how can he remove these confusions.
Thank you for your nice question. I think it is laminal flow, not luminal.
Yes.
Laminar flow. Laminar. Yes. There is no luminal, laminar. And turbulent. So,
yes.
First of all, in any echocardiography, you have to use your 2D. You are, without doing anything, you should not go for the color Doppler. First, you see 2D and see is there any echo dropout. So, in 2D, ASD or BSD will come as echo dropout. So, if you see an echo dropout, now you have to confirm whether there is any crossing of blood through this dropout. Sometimes there is aneurysmal tissue. And there is no shunt. Because you know the child, they always have some possibility of spontaneous closure. And that spontaneous closure is sometime by the aneurysmal tissue, sometime on the tricuspid valve, sometime on the prolapse RCC in case of VSD. So you have to look for those and you have to clear your confusion by putting your color. So if you see that color is crossing, if there is laminar flow, that means across the defect, that means that there is no pressure gradient across the defect. Laminar flow through a VSD or ASD means it is a very large defect. And if there is turbulence, it is a restrictive defect. That's why blood is creating turbulence to cross that defect. So turbulence is from the restriction of flow. And smooth flow, laminar flow through a defect is from the large defect where there is no restriction. Right ventricle, left ventricle, same pressure or little bit less pressure, so blood is going easily. Now, even if you have, there is a confusion with the flow, now, lastly, you apply your CW or PW and you see whether there is any flow. Sometimes we also have confusion. So we place, across the septum, we place the cursor of the CW or PW and we see if there is any flow. If there is any flow, you will catch it in your CW, there will be flow. But if there is no flow, then it is not any defect. So there may be some smooth aneurysmal tissue, you are not getting that. So in those cases, for adult, you can go for the, and poor, if there is poor echo window, you can go for the transesophageal in those cases for the adult. But for us, we can manage. Somehow or other, we find the clue. I have mentioned earlier that a disease cannot happen in isolated way. There are some changes in the chamber of the heart. And if you feel that this is a large BSD, this is a severe pulmonary hypertension, there is laminar flow, you don't understand what to do. You just look for the right ventricle. You will see that there is severe right ventricular hypertrophy. There is RV volume overload. You measure the TR. You will see that there will be the TR, 2 months of the pulmonary pressure. So if you don't get any direct evidence, go for the indirect evidence. And then you will get everything. Don't miss indirect evidence. Sometimes you will not get direct evidence. You will see that the indirect evidence, and then come back to your status again. Come back to your position again, and then you will find it. Thank you.
Thank you, madam. I think sometimes we have to take the help of contrast echocardiography as well, saline contrast echo. The next question
is for the ASD.
Yes, madam.
Yes.
Another related question is, what are the criteria for diagnosis of ASD in apical four chamber view? Is it necessary to do subcostal view?
Actually, heart is not like a square or not like a circle, not like it is a peculiar structure, triangular shape, and if you measure ASD from different view, you will get different measurement. So it is better actually to, if you can see, what is the harm of seeing from the subcostal view? It will not cost any more money for you. So it is just time. And if you are so busy that you have no time to look for the subcostal view, you must have time for thorough analysis. So you have to do all the views. Because measurement in four chamber view and subcostal view may be little bit different, especially the rims. You will not get the rims equally in all these views. So if you want to do ASD device closure, you have to see, for example, IBC, SBC rim, you will see better in those views. So ASD is not a single entity. ASD is related with many other things, especially for the treatment purpose. You are not doing only echo for doing echo. You are doing echo so that the patient will get treatment. So what kind of treatment you will suggest? They will come out from all kind of analysis, and then you will suggest that this patient is suitable for ASD closure or ASD surgical closure. Thank you.
Thank you, madam. So for exclusion of ASD, subcostal view is must. If you cannot get subcostal view, especially in adults, you may take the help of off-axis view. But these sorts of views are must because of the orientation of the interdictal septum in particular. Another question from Dr. Robiul Islam Sarkar. What makes T sign in ASD? Please show the limbs. Need more about ASD limb measurement.
I don't know whether I have photograph of T sign. T sign is like a T. I can show you with the column button. I am bringing a pen just to show you T sign. So this is my pen. So this is the limb of T, this one, and this is the one. So this is T. Now what is this thing in the ASD? This is actually the ASD hole. This one is the ASD hole, and this one is the end from where the septum starts. So this is the part from where the septum starts, and this part is ASD, and this is the septum. So from this mark to this mark, you will measure the ASD. This is the solid part of the septum, and this one is absent. So this is the T sign. Understand? Thank you.
Madam, he wants to know more about the measurement of rims in ASD, device closure.
Measurement of rim, actually, we have many rims. But for me, actually, I am doing ASD disclosure with my consultant in Saudi Arabia since 1997. So initially, I did with under cover of my consultant. At that time, it took 5-6 hours to do one ASD device closure. And I was scared of ASD. If I saw that there is an ASD in the list of the cath lab, so I that day it was actually a very tough day, and 5-6 hours standing in the cath lab with a lead apron, it was actually very tough. So in those time there was like measurement various ways, But for me, what I have simplified everything. I don't like complication. And I have simplified my things in my way. And what I do like in a four-chamber boat, four-chamber view, where I can see the tricuspid valve and mitral valve closed, in closed position. Mitral valve, tricuspid valve in closed position. Then I put the four-chamber view and I measure the inferior rim from middle of two valves up to the ASD and from the roof of the heart to the ASD. So these are my superior and inferior rim. And then, but you know, there are many, many rims, anterosuperior, anteroinferior, posterosuperior, posteroinferior, aortic rim, IVC rim, SVC rim. All these rims are important for a beginner because any rim less than, previously our teacher, they used to say that any rim less than 7 millimeter is not acceptable. But nowadays, 5 millimeter aortic rim, like 4 millimeter, we accept. And these are actually off-label, we accept. But in our beginning part of our story, it was not like that. So for me, I measure superior rim, inferior rim, and I just see for the aortic rim because the aortic rim is very important. For what? There are some reasons for that. Because there is chance of erosion of the aorta. If you place the device, the lower end of the device, compressing the aorta, then in future there may be chance of erosion of the aortic valve. So you must have a safe exit from that. So your device, lower end of your device, should not compress the aorta. So I just looked at carefully in short axis view that the aortic rim is enough to hold the lower end of the device and it will not compress the aorta so that there will be erosion in future. You have seen that there are in the reports that there are some erosion, and FDA a few years ago they said stop doing ASD closure because two patients had erosion. So only two patients reported with the erosion and they said you stop doing ASD device closure. It is not good. And so these are the things which are going on in America, the country where everything is reported and everything has, you know, they have like authority to supervise all those things. But in our country, alhamdulillah, I have like ASD, how many cases? I have no recent data, but it is like more than 1400. So far, I have never seen any ASD device erosion, causing erosion in the aortic root. So aortic rim is important for that reason. And IVC rim is another important because that is against the gravity. That rim gives support because when you walk with the device, you need some support from the against the gravity. So that rim is important for that purpose, IVC. So you can measure, but for me, practically, I don't measure all those things because I have some third eye. I can see everything and from long experience. But for you, you have to see all the rings, IVC rim, SVC rim from the subcostal view and retroaortic rim, then aortic rims, anterior superior, anterior posterior, all the rims you have to look. But I summate all these rings. There is no superior inferior. Superior is the summation of like SVC rim and the anterior superior like this. But I do like this. This is superior for me. This is enough for me. This is inferior. This is enough for me. Aortic enough for me. So this varies with the experience of the interventional cardiologist.
Thank you, madam. I think there is a basic difference in ASD device closure in pediatric patients as well as in adult patients. In case of device closure of ASD in adult patients, TE is virtually indispensable. You have to do TE before proceeding for the device closure. And for the pediatric patients, transthoracic echo may be good enough. One thing, and the last question for the time being, how can different types of VSD can be diagnosed by echocardiography? This has been asked by Dr. Ashaduzzaman.
So you have to know the anatomy of the ventricular septum. Ventricular septum has perimembranous part and the muscular part, then outlet part like this. So according to the position, location of the VSD, nomenclature has been done. So if it is like in the perimembranous region, in the membranous septum, it is perimembranous VSD and very nicely it can be visualized from the parasternal long axis view. And For the muscular BSD, periosternal long axis view, four chamber view, even short axis view, where ventricular septum is visible with all the chambers like left atrium, right atrium, atrial septum. I showed you that view. From that view, you can also see some of the BSD. For the apical muscular BSD, especially, we have to go to that view. And even the short axis view, where we measure the ventricular function, in that view, you can see also the muscular BSDs. And inlet BSD, like apical defect, you can see very nicely from the four chamber view with two valves together. And for the doubly committed BSD, you can see nicely from the short axis view. In short axis view, aortic valve will come as circle and pulmonary valve on the side. And you will see that blood is coming out from the ventricular septum and directly hitting the pulmonary valve. So the ventricular jet, the flow of the jet will directly hit the pulmonary valve and you will get some pulmonary stenosis, but that is not pulmonary stenosis. You will actually mistake by writing pulmonary stenosis, but this is a flow related because the BSD jet directly hits the pulmonary valve and enters into the pulmonary artery. So that gives an impression like pulmonary stenosis, but it is a flow related from the BSD jet. So you will get in that view that doubly committed. Why it is doubly committed? Because it is committed to the aortic valve, it is committed to the pulmonary valve. And doubly committed BSD is one of the bad kind of BSD, which never close continuously and needs surgical closure. And it is not also for the device closure, but I did some of the cases of the doubly committed with the devices, maybe like about 15 cases. Luckily, I got some space below the aortic valve to place the device, and then it was successful. Those were successful.
Thank you, madam.
ম্যাডাম খুব এত সুন্দর ভাবে মানে সহজ করে কঠিন মানে কঠিন মানে আমাদের কাছে কঠিন আর কি সহজ করে কঠিন জিনিসগুলো বুঝিয়েছেন ম্যাডামকে অনেক ধন্যবাদ ম্যাডাম যদি বিএসডি ক্ষেত্রে ওভাররাইডিংটা যদি একটু বলতেন ওভাররাইডিং দেখে আমরা কি কি করতে পারি যেমন আমরা শিখছি যে 50% এর নিচে হলে কি হবে 50% এর উপরে হলে কি হবে যদি একটু সহজ ভাবে বলতেন ম্যাডাম ওভাররাইডিং অফ দ্য অর্ডার ইন বিএসডি
আপনার কথাটা শুনি নাই বিএসডি কি লার্জ স্মল এগুলি
ম্যাডাম ওভাররাইডিং অফ দ্য অ্যাওর্টা পার্সেন্টেজ ইন কেস অফ বিএসডি
আচ্ছা 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 আই আন্ডারস্ট্যান্ড সো দ্য টিপ অফ দ্য ভেন্ট্রিকুলার সেপটাম ইজ অ্যাকচুয়ালি দ্য পয়েন্ট ফ্রম হোয়ার ইউ হ্যাভ টু মেজার সো ইওর ভেন্ট্রিকুলার সেপটাম হ্যাজ এ টপ মোস্ট পয়েন্ট দ্য টিপ এট দ্য টিপ এন্ড ফ্রম দেয়ার ইউ হ্যাভ টু মেজার the aortic valve position of the aortic like the annulus of the aorta if it is just in the middle touching point of the cusp then it is 50% so if I get a picture I can go there again
Assalamu alaikum. Very good morning to everyone, and also thanks to Professor Noornar Fatima. He is the legend of pediatric cardiology in Bangladesh, and heard many beautiful and very easy things from him. I think it is very much helpful for the young cardiologist, echocardiographer. From my opinion, that from my experience, that we cannot learn echocardiography by reading a book. We had so many big books, but that books are very much large, and we cannot go through the all chapter line by line. But it is very, I think, not very good to. Digest all the things. So to learn an echocardiography, my advice to our fellows, please took the probe in your hand and you start echocardiography in your echo room with very patience and a long time, even the patient is normal. But you can try to evaluate all the windows and all the pictures like a book picture. You all, those who are doing echocardiography, they are all cardiologists and they have sufficient knowledge, background knowledge about the congenital abnormalities, whatever it is, and what is the basics of echo. So for a good echocardiographer, you have to take the probe, right probe that Dr. Fatima also nicely expressed about the know the machine, know the probe, for which patient, which probe is appropriate. For pediatric patient, I think probe is different. For adult patient, probe is different. For thick and thin person, probe is different. For subcostal view, probe is different. And also T is something different. So you know the probe and you choose the right probe and you start your echo from a very, like a beginner, like a, just we learn from very beginning that the parasternal long axis view, short axis view, apical, and the subcostal views. But you have to be very patient, so you have to be very gentle, you have to be very give time to echocardiography to view the correct view of echocardiography. In my experience, that so there are so many echocardiographers nowadays, that is all are cardiologists, but they cannot even in the screen, they cannot get the proper view. That's why they miss anything. And before doing an echo, my advice is to take a short history of the patient, just 1 to 2 comment, just go through the ECG and also an X-ray. That will give you a proper guideline in which direction you have to go through the echocardiography. For a congenital, there is different issue. For a pediatric, it is a different issue. For an adult cardiologist patient, you have to a different way. So please, for everyone, my advice, please go through a short history and a X-ray and ECG before doing an echocardiography. And then you start echocardiography, you will, I think you will get the correct result from the echocardiography. And you give more time to get the better and best picture for an echocardiography, all the views. Not just like a parasternal view and give a cursor over there and take a ejection fraction from the echocardiography. And for congenital heart disease, most of our fellows actually they usually call me, they please sir confirm that this patient have any ASD or not. Very simple. That is during echocardiography, parasternal long axis view, apical four chamber view, there is some dropout in the IAS. There is a false dropout and there is no shunt, but they confused that there is an echo dropout and there is an ASD also. So from if I go there, then I told everyone, please check the not only the dropout, you check that the that Dr. Noor Fatima mentioned that if there is a shunt, there may be the chamber dilatation. Some other supportive evidence. If there is an ASD, there is a dilatation of the right atrium, dilatation of the right ventricle, and also the pulmonary artery. So if there is no dilatation, all chambers are normal, then echo dropout if you see by a 2D echocardiography and also sometimes color echocardiography, you may confuse that there is an ASD. So please, if there is any ASD you suspect, you search for the secondary changes that usually occurs in during the shunt anomaly. Even in the VSD, in the PDA, if there is a PDA, there is a pulmonary dilatation. So all the simple thing, you have to be correlate with other findings of the heart, the chambers, the valves, etc., etc. So for an echocardiographer, the main thing is his patience and the more attention to visualize the best picture and the best views on the echocardiography machine. And I agree with the Noorna Fatima, for the beginners and for all the cardiologists for pediatric echocardiography, actually the transthoracic echocardiography is enough to evaluate a case. Not TE is always required. Even during the procedure of ASD and VSD closure, I think PDA closure, no need to do a transesophageal echocardiography. Even in adult case, I did more than 100 cases of ASD device closure without any TE, just only the transthoracic echocardiography. But before doing the closure, in adult patient, I do the transesophageal echocardiography to assess all the rims and the size of the ASD, size of the VSD, these are the things. But if I have the pre-procedural complete picture of the patient, then the things are very easy in the cath lab. And sometimes no rim or very inadequate rim anywhere, then I think for the beginner, don't proceed for device closure. It actually we may fail. But from my experience with the experts in other areas where they usually do their device closure regularly, even without any rim somewhere, they can actually put the device there by some other assistance, like other puncture and some other wires, some other supportive guide catheter, supportive catheter, they can put the ASD device closer in a inadequate frame. So last of all, I must congratulate Dr. Noorna Fatima for his brilliant picture for the beginners and also for us also. Thank you very much. Thank you for patience hearing. Okay, Manoj.
Okay. Any comment, sir? Professor Miska?
No, sir. I have got no comment. Madam.
No, no. So we like to hear from you, sir.
Dr. Manoj.
Sir.
Do you like to have the second presentation today, or you can?
Sir, I think this can be deferred.
Huh?
Second presentation can be in another day.
Dr. Govindo?
I am agree with you, sir. It's because we are running short of time. Already 12.
It is already 12, and the topic is very vast. I think all the other faculty may like to contribute to this faculty. Mm-hmm. I think the next week or the following week, Dr. Govindopal will present his presentation.
Exactly.
Yes.
So
it's a whole presentation, I think.
Meskad, you don't like to talk anything?
Madam Shampurge, to bolte chaichilam, sir.
There is only these scientific comments, no social comments.
I understand, sir. But the thing that has to be given emphasis is the way knowledge is transformed into wisdom. Since Madam was a little hesitant about talking on this basic subject to a very widespread learned gathering, but what a person acquires over years of experience and years of dedication, which is integrated with knowledge. And whenever, whatever she presents, very simple, very ordinary, becomes very, very wisdomful. So that is the beauty of simple thing when it is being delivered by a very wise person. Madam is a person who has developed to be a cardiologist, pediatric cardiologist, which is such an example to me, personally for me, because she is a place of comfort. Every time I depend on her, every time I see her, I know she's doing the right thing, she's doing the perfect thing, and she's the one whom we can trust most, and we can learn accurately from her. Also, we have Kabir Zaman and Tuhin as echocardiographer, very dedicated and very trustworthy. Sir, you have gathered all these people, Shejanna. I like to express my gratitude to you also. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. We have
I have one question to Brigadier Nornar. I refrain from asking questions due to the short of time. But now, in the tricuspid ataxia, you say that there must be ASD. And also there should be a PhD. But there is another connection should be there, not only the ASD. Either
PhD or BSD
should be there.
Yes, sir. If I see whether there is, yes, sir. So, sir, if there is any ASD, then the atrial, the cardiac output will be maintained from the right atrium to the left atrium, then it will go to the left ventricle. Now, what will happen to the pulmonary artery? Because if blood cannot enter into pulmonary artery, there will be no return to the left side of the heart, there will be no cardiac output to the aorta. So that blood, there must be a way so that blood can enter into the pulmonary artery and then come back to the left side of the heart. So there must be a VSD. If there is no VSD, then the blood will not enter into the left ventricle, right ventricle, and then it will not enter into the pulmonary artery. Now, in some cases, tricuspid atresia is associated with pulmonary atresia. So this right ventricle then works as a dormant chamber. There is tricuspid atresia, there is pulmonary atresia. So there is no need of blood to enter into the right ventricle. This is a dormant chamber and this is out of circulation. In that case, VSD is not required. But in the case, if a baby survives, PDA should be there so that blood will from here to here, it will enter directly into the aorta. And from aorta, blood will go into the pulmonary artery through the PDA. And then that blood will come back to the left atrium with oxygenated blood. So these are the ways, sir, step by step, we have to look for all those. But first phase of survival is the ASD. Second is plus minus VSD. Third is plus minus PDA.
With the permission of chair, I have a simple or small question to the madam, renowned.
Yes.
You've got the priority. Dr. Govinda has got the priority of asking any question.
Right. It's my great pleasure.
You have two questions.
Madam, please, it's a brilliant talk, very simplified way. It is easy, understandable, perceptible, all of us. My question regarding measurement of PFO, patent foramen ovale. How can we measure? As because there is a flap, two flap overlying each other. How can you measure this hole in case of PFO?
In case of PFO, actually, it is you rightly said it is a tunnel. So it is very difficult to measure the tunnel. You may find the opening of the tunnel on the right side or on the left side. But what I personally do is I give the color Doppler there. And then I measure from the middle of the color Doppler. So if it is like this is the PFO. So when color cross, I try to find this position, this middle one.
Yeah.
For the measurement with the color Doppler. Or you can do it that even with the 2D, the middle one. So PFO may be small, may be large. Not always, not all PFOs are small. Some PFOs are very large. And we...
Yes, some books are written according to size.
it differentiate between PFO and ASD. That means in books I have seen the below 7 millimeter is PFO and more than 7 millimeter ASD. This PFO, is authentic
no,
or not?
No, PFO is a separate entity. It is a flap tunnel like thing, and ASD is like it is equal. It is like the between the septum secondum and primum. It is the fossa ovalis area, not in the septum secondum primum. It is in the area of fossa ovalis. In the meantime.
Thank you, madam.
I like to put one question that has been asked by Dr. Ashaduzzaman Talukdar. How can DORV be differentiated from TOF in echocardiography? Double outlet right ventricle, double outlet right ventricle, and tetralogy of Fallot.
Actually, double outlet right ventricle is a very big entity. There are four types of double outlet right ventricle. So that one type among the double outlet right ventricle is TOF-like physiology, not anatomy. So what is the simple meaning of double outlet right ventricle? It means that both aorta and pulmonary artery is coming out from the right ventricle either completely or as percentage. For example, according to the 50% phenomena, if a chamber is more than 50% with another chamber, then that goes to that chamber. So if there is overriding of the aorta 50% or more to the right side of the heart, then it is a double outlet right ventricle. So double outlet right ventricle may have non-restrictive pulmonary blood flow. There is no pulmonary stenosis. May have restrictive pulmonary blood flow. So if and double outlet ventricle must have a VSD. So all the double outlet ventricle must have VSD. Otherwise, patient will die because there is no outlet for the left ventricle. So all the double outlet have VSD. That is true. That is universal. Now, what is the position of the great vessel? Great vessel may be normally placed. So that DORB where the great vessel is normal, that is like a simple VSD. In the situations where great vessel are normal, normally aligned, there is no transposition, where there is stenosis, those are TOF-like. So they are double outlet right ventricle with pulmonary stenosis, with ventricular septal defect. And their physiology is just like tetralogy of flow. So their management will be like that. Another type is great vessel is transposed. So aorta come to the position of pulmonary artery and pulmonary to the aorta. These are TOSIC being anomalies. So one kind of DORB is TOSIC being anomalies. One kind of DORB is TOF type. One kind of DORB is VSD type. Another kind of VSD where the VSD is very remote from the aorta and pulmonary artery. So in those kind, normally there is no problem with us, but the problem is for the surgeon because the VSD is remote. So they have to tunnel that VSD to the aorta so that kind of repair is known as IVTR or intraventricular tunnel repair. That is for the purpose of the surgery, that is difficult, but for us, we can diagnose the remote VSD with normally related great arteries. So what you mentioned is tetralogy of Fallot. How can you differentiate from double outlet? So if it is 50% overriding aorta, up to 50%, we can say that it is tetralogy of Fallot. But if it is more than 50%, 60% overriding, 70% overriding to the right ventricular side, and you are seeing that right ventricular outflow is directly going to the aorta more than that of the left ventricle, then you can make the percentage, you can measure the percentage. Normally at the connection point of the aortic valve at the crux, we just measure the percentage. So if it is more than 50%, it is DORB. But there is actually no problem of whether you say TOF or DORB because management is same, physiology is same, surgery is same. So just 5% difference of measurement is not a big deal.
Thank you, madam. I think this easy rule will help the adult cardiologists. Dr. Rabiul Islam Sarkar wants to know how to measure PDA. How to measure PDA?
Sorry, Monar bhai.
How to measure PDA? So, PDA is a communication between the aorta and pulmonary artery. So, you can measure the PDA at the aortic end. There are many types of measurement. You can measure the PDA at the very narrowest point. You can measure the PDA, if possible, at the pulmonary end. So end wise you can measure the PDA, but for us, the pediatric cardiologist, we actually measure the narrowest point in the middle. So whatever is the narrowest point, because if we try to do the device closure, we need to know the narrowest point. So narrowest point, but you can measure the length also, not only the diameter, you can measure the length. Actually, we don't measure that much of the thing. For me, I only measure the narrowest point and the pressure gradient. Why pressure gradient is important? To categorize it as small, large, medium. So if there is too much PPG, peak pressure gradient, it is a small PDA. If there is like less than 30, we say that it is large PDA. If it is 30 to 50, we say it is moderate PDA. And then we go for the chamber, whether there is left heart dilatation, how much. And you know that PDA is most of the time associated with mitral valve polyps. So you have to look for the mitral valve also. It is all most of the time associated with MR, because left heart dilatation results from, you know, non-coaptation. So there is MR most of the time. So you have to look for all those things. Thank you.
Thank you, madam. Yes.
ম্যাডাম কে দুটো প্রশ্ন করতেছি একটা প্রথম প্রথমটা মনোয় ভাই কোশ্চেনের একটা কনসিস্টেন্স হিসেবে যে আমরা জানি দ্য ফিট মোর দ্যান 50%
লাউডলি বলো লাউডলি জোরে বলো লাউড প্লিজ
শোনা যাচ্ছে
ইওর আপনার পরিচয় দেন প্রথমে
আমি ডক্টর অজয় কুমার দত্ত এখন সিলেটে কাজ করতেছি একটা প্রাইভেট হসপিটালে ম্যাডামের কাছে প্রশ্ন ডিওআরবি ডায়াগনোসিসে আমরা জানি যে মোর দ্যান 50% ওভাররাইডিং বাট aorto mitral discontinuity is mandatory. I mean, sub-aortic cornas is mandatory for the diagnosis.
There are various criteria. So those are also criteria. And aorto mitral discontinuity is evident in DORB. It is a criteria of DORB.
Another question, madam. PDA device closure, আমরা যে গ্রেডিয়েন্টটা নিব, সেটা কি ডায়াস্টল গ্রেডিয়েন্ট ইজ মোর সিগনিফিক্যান্ট অর পিক গ্রেডিয়েন্ট আমরা নিব কারণ আমরা জানি পিক গ্রেডিয়েন্ট ইজ রিলেটেড টু দা হাই টরেনশিয়াল ফ্লো সো ইট ক্যান
অবভিয়াসলি হ্যাঁ থ্যাংক ইউ আই আন্ডারস্ট্যান্ড ইওর কোশ্চেন অ্যাকচুয়ালি ইন পিডিএ দেয়ার ইজ কন্টিনিউয়াস মারমার এন্ড দেয়ার ইজ কন্টিনিউয়াস ফ্লো সো দেয়ার ইজ নট দ্যাট মাচ অফ দা ডিফারেন্স বিটুইন সিস্টোলিক এন্ড ডায়াস্টোলিক ফ্লো বিকজ ইফ ইউ কনসিডার ফর এক্সাম্পল প্রেশার systolic pressure of aorta is 100 mm mercury and diastolic pressure is 50 mm mercury in systole. So gradient is 50 mm mercury. Now if diastolic pressure of the aorta is like 60 mm mercury and diastolic pressure of pulmonary artery is like 25 mm mercury, again you are seeing that there is gradient of like 45-40. So all the time you are getting a gradient across the PDA between the aorta and the pulmonary artery in systole and in diastole. Always there is gradient. So blood will continue to flow both in systole and in diastole. So there you will see in the CW, there is a continuous flow. Sometimes it is a straight line type of flow. There is no ups and downs. But if the systolic gradient is more, it is a rule of physics. I have nothing to do with that. And you have nothing to do with that. So this is a physics. According to the physics, if there is systolic gradient is higher than the diastolic gradient, then you will get little bit higher envelope in the systole and little bit less envelope in the diastole. But peak pressure gradient we measure in PDA in the flows where systole is important. In those cases, we measure in systole. So peak pressure gradient we will measure in the systolic flow. But these are continuous. Most of the time, you will get the same type of flow. If you see the CW flow of the PDA. It is like a straight line in the top one.
Thank you, madam.
Dr. Muhammad Ashraful Islam has raised hand. Dr. Rajiv, will you arrange him to interact with us? Dr. Rajiv. We have a good number of experts in echocardiography of Bangladesh with us. Now, I'd like to invite Professor Tuhin Bhav to say a few comments or anything regarding today's presentation. Professor Tuhin Bhav, madam.
Thank you, Manor, for giving me the opportunity. I'd like to congratulate Dr. Brigadier Noor Nahar Fatima for her excellent presentation.
she needs no introduction, and everybody praised her. She is an excellent presenter and makes the difficult thing very easy. Just for the fellows, I want to add the importance of subcostal echo window in case of ASD. What happens in apical four chamber view? The interior septum is really relatively parallel to the ultrasound beam. So the thin fossa ovalis area, there becomes a false shadow and the false echo dropout. So false ASD is very common in apical four chamber view. But when the subcostal echo window is clear, the ultrasound beam cuts the iris in the perpendicular to the iris. So with gain setting, we can see clearly the iris. So to rule out ASD or to confirm ASD, subcostal echo window is must. If subcostal echo window is inadequate, then we should go for transesophageal echo. And another thing to differentiate between the DRV and TOF. So anatomical DRV, there must be automatal discontinuity. But in case of TOF variety DRV, automatal continuity would be preserved. So to differentiate between TOF and DRV with automatal continuity, when the overriding is more than 50%, it should be the TOF variety DRV. And one thing I want to learn from my germs, what is your experience about the COVID in this Kawasaki in this era? Because frequently babies are referred to look for the coronaries, and coronary dilatation occur many weeks after the original disease. So what is your follow-up protocol for to look for the COVID in this Kawasaki?
So, thank you, Dr. Tuhin Hong, for your nice question. Actually, we have seen three cases already of Kawasaki disease. I don't know whether these are related to COVID. Actually, nowadays, most of the time, COVID tests become positive and these are false positive. I feel that these are false positive some of the time. Anyways, these are known as MISC, multi-inflammatory syndrome in children. Multi-system inflammatory syndrome in children, MISC. So we had three cases, and in those cases, there were some dilatation, but I have never seen any aneurysmal dilatation. I got a patient 2 days ago. He came with report from another hospital. This child had history of COVID-19 positive RT-PCR 1 month ago. And then she came with a report that there is aneurysmal dilatation, and she was advised to admit for getting some treatment. So I did the echo and I found there are some dilatation, but there is no aneurysmal dilatation. History was 1 month ago. And it was standard deviation was like 2.5. Coronary artery dilatation was only 2.5. So up to 2 is normal, it was 2.5. And then I gave only echo screen. There was nothing because it was 1 month ago. So if you need to give like immunosuppressive therapy, IVIG, we should give it in within 7 days of illness. Now, but if somebody report later and if there is any dilatation, then in those cases we can give like antiplatelet drugs in low dose, like 5 mg/kg body weight. If there is any aneurysmal dilatation, in those cases we can give warfarin because there is chance of platelet aggregation and thrombus formation. So in those cases we add warfarin. But so far I have not received any cases with the aneurysm formation, which I see in many of my cases with Kawasaki disease, and they are getting those kind of treatment. But here in our CMH, I had 2 cases, but we have given only IVIG and they improve later. So we do their follow-up, like first echo we do today, then after 7 days we do another echo, after 2 weeks we do another. Then when we discharge, we tell them to come for first follow-up after 1 month, second follow-up after 3 months, and then 6 monthly until coronary measurement becomes normal. And we continue giving echo screen until coronary measurement comes down normal. And another message for the adult cardiologists who are doing coronaries. Nowadays, you will see some of the cases with beaded appearance of the coronary arteries. Those cases, they had Kawasaki disease in their infancy. You know that Kawasaki disease is a disease up to 5 years of age. After that, it usually never happened. So those cases where you see some regional dilatation one after another, beaded appearance, these are actually the Kawasaki disease in their young age or in their infancy. And they grow up and then ultimately they develop adult coronary disease. So Kawasaki disease is a cause of adult coronary artery disease. Thank you.
Thank you, madam.
Thank you, madam. we have Professor ABM Abdul Salam. He is one of the leading pediatric cardiologists in the country. May I ask, sir, to make some comments? Professor ABM Abdul Salam.
I beg pardon of you. Actually, I think there are some miscommunication or misunderstanding regarding the topics of today's presentation with Madam. Because we saw this is the percutaneous pediatric cardiac intervention and its ECHO, role of ECHO. So I think Madam had some miscommunication, first of all. So I think we can hear from her another day regarding the role of echocardiography in pediatric intervention, number one. Number two is regarding the question of Professor Shafi Mujumdar Sir. Thinking of my small addition to the madam has described everything. One thing is that is the tricuspid atresia, in case of tricuspid atresia, VHD must be there or not. But she has given a good example, but another example very common in univentricular heart, when tricuspid atresia with LV, DOLV. So in that case, you do not require any VHD. That is another thing. And another supplementary comment regarding the measurement of PFO. Actually, PFO is a slit-tight structure as shown by Professor Behrian Rulnar Fatima. You can measure the length as well as the diameter, narrowest diameter, and LSI diameter and RSI diameter, if you want to go to closure by PFO closure device, number one. And also you should see the flow, whether it is bidirectional, left to right, or right to left. This is very important. And sometimes you need to contrast ECHO if there is cryptogenic, history of cryptogenic stroke. Secondly, what I want to know...
Sir, can you be a bit louder?
Yes, sir.
Louder, please.
Regarding her presentation, it is as before as always. She usually give very smart presentation. Today is no exception. She has done excellent in her presentation, starting from the segmental analysis up to the intervention. And the thing is, many things cannot be covered by one lecture. That is the problem. And I have given one lecture on segmental analysis in the last week. But I think it is a repetition also. And regarding her presentation, I already told that it was excellent and we enjoyed it. And another lot of achievement in her life, but three important achievements I want to highlight. One is Independence Award, the highest civilian award she was. And for that, we, not only the doctor, pediatric cardiologist, the whole medical faculty of Bangladesh are proud of it for her achievement. And second is another milestone of achievement, that is the first percutaneous pulmonary valve implantation in pediatric population or adolescent population. And that was the first in Southeast Asia. And that is her milestone of development. And another is her regarding her social work. I myself and herself, Professor Virian Luna Fatima, Brigadier Musa Khan, and Dr. Kazi Abul Hassan, and some other 24 pediatric cardiologists, surgeons, and anesthesiologists. We are organizing a social platform, CHTB, that is Child Heart Trust Bangladesh. It was started with National Professor Himal Khan's inspiration. Now, our research counselor is the president, and Madam is the vice president. So far, we have contributed to 175 patients and donating about nearly 80 lakhs to them from our Jakarta. Cardiologist, you can contribute to your zakat, some portion of your zakat to our fund, so that we can help our poor patient. So that is my comment from my side, and I always pray for madam for a long life, long healthy life, so that he can more contribute to the nation. Thank you very much. Thank you, Professor Shafi sir and his team. Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. We have in our panel.
Manohar.
Sir.
Manohar.
Sir.
Dr. Ashraf Bode Ashe Biute.
Oh.
Our fellow.
That's a ticket, sir. Dr. Ashraf. Some other persons have also raised their hands, but I think there is some technical difficulties. I cannot see them. Dr. Rajiv of Beximco Pharma, can you arrange those participants to bring into light? I like to give chance for others.
আমাদের কবিরুল জামান আছে, খালিদ মোহসিন
আচ্ছা,
খালিদ মোহসিন কিছু বলবে নাকি? দেখো
খালিদ মোহসিন লেট, খালিদ মোহসিন স্যার, দো আই হ্যাভ মেক সাম কমেন্টস.
I am not a dedicated echocardiographer or a pediatric cardiologist, but I enjoyed the talk from the very beginning. And she covered almost everything from the probe selection, preparation to intervention, everything she has covered. And the three-story building approach has appealed to me very much. And as an adult cardiologist, we are mainly concerned about the electrical system and the plumbing. But she... I think she has extended our outlook much beyond. I have a question to her. She has already described that in some detail, that in the COVID era, there is some Kawasaki-like involvement of the pediatric patient. So I have a question to her, that how much of the coronary artery you can visualize in the pediatric patient? And from that, can you draw a conclusion about this sort of illness, or you need to resort to some other modalities of imaging in diagnosing the Kawasaki or Kawasaki illness in the COVID era?
I will show you. I think I have a Kawasaki echo. I'll just show you. In actually, right coronary artery is not visualized that much, but left coronary artery we can see LED up to 2/3 of the distance. I don't have that much expertise on coronary, but I can see a long distance even up to the apex or the LED. But the circumflex, I can see like behind the aorta, up to that much we can see. And right coronary artery, actually, we don't see that much. Maybe first 1/3 we can see. But the good thing is that the aneurysmal dilatation usually occurs in this part, the part which we visualize. So I'm trying you to show a Kawasaki echo from here. Just a second, I'm showing. So we can measure this. We have some normogram, so we always measure it and then we do the standard deviation, and then we can find if it is more than 2 standard deviation. I'm looking for a Kawasaki. I think we have a Kawasaki here. It is not a Kawasaki, but this is another one you can see here. So you are seeing that this is the aorta. So we can see this is the right coronary. We are seeing this is not for the Kawasaki, but for other purpose.
We are not seeing, madam.
You are not seeing? Oh.
Not seeing at all.
Yeah,
okay. Oh, this is very interesting one. I want to show you this one.
You can show us the coronaries, how to visualize the coronaries. Whether it is a Kawasaki or the coronary fistula, I am seeing. You got
even,
this
even
line
normal,
of the coronary.
Even normal coronary, you can show us.
Normal, yeah.
Can you see it now?
No, madam. Yes.
Can you see now?
Yeah.
Yes, madam.
See, this is the pulmonary artery and this is the aorta. So this is right coronary artery and left, it should come from here, but we are not seeing any left coronary artery. So now I see here, this is the pulmonary artery. See, here is a coronary artery, there are two branches. This is one branch and this is one branch. So this is the main coronary artery. Can you understand from this video? This is the main coronary artery.
Sometimes it is being visible. Right now.
Just observe. Yeah, just observe, you will understand. This is a very interesting case of El Capa. So, just understand from... So, this is the coronary artery. The cursor is on the coronary artery. You are seeing that there are two branches, main coronary artery. Red one is in this side and the LAD on that side. So, the red color one is the circumflex and then other one is the LAD. This one. So, from this video, we have diagnosed L kappa. So, coronary artery is coming from the coming out from the pulmonary artery in this this patient. So, in this way, we can actually see the coronary arteries. It's not very difficult. I have a picture of Kawasaki, but I'm not getting it here. I'm just looking for another time. Because Kawasaki is a very common picture now nowadays. And for a long time, I am working on Kawasaki disease.
On KD is there, on KD, Kawasaki disease, KD, yes, yes.
Not only one, KD2 also present.
Yeah, so see, this is the origin of the left coronary artery. Here you are seeing that this is too much confluence. So this is the confluence of the left coronary artery before division. Here is one division and another division we are not seeing here. So this confluence is enlarged. So measurement was 5.4 millimeter and most possibly in a standard deviation, it will be like 4. So this is one KD. And now I will show you another. KD2. So here you are seeing, now this is the aneurysm part. This is the, are you seeing the origin of the coronary artery here?
Yes, madam.
And aneurysmal dilatation here?
Yes.
So just observe, this is the aneurysmal dilatation of the LAD.
Beautiful image, madam. Nicely.
So this is one of my patients few days ago. So these are not actually, if you work on a thing, you will learn it quickly. And here is the place from where RCA originate. And RCA, we can't see that much, but LAD, we can see up to like this part. So this is the Kawasaki. And I hope all of you who are seeing today will be able to diagnose current Kawasaki disease from next day.
Madam, it is কত মিলিমিটারের উপরে হলে অ্যানুরিজম বলবো ম্যাডাম এটাকে করোনারি আর্টারি অ্যানুরিজম
এইটা তো আসলে আপনাকে ওই যে স্ট্যান্ডার্ড ডেভিয়েশনে ফেলতে হবে আমরা মোর দ্যান 4 বলে বলি যে এটা অ্যানুরিজমাল ডাইলেটেশন এটা আপনি ইতে পাবেন মোবাইল অ্যাপসে পাবেন হাউ টু মেজার করোনারি আর্টারিজ স্ট্যান্ডার্ড ডেভিয়েশন এগুলো অ্যাপসে পাওয়া যায় সবার মোবাইলে এগুলো থাকে
থ্যাংক ইউ ম্যাডাম
ভেরি ওয়েলকাম
মনোয়ার Can I ask something?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Regarding the question of
the... Sir, you should be a bit loud.
Yeah.
We cannot hear you properly.
Okay. Can you hear?
Not optimally.
Okay.
This is a presentation in the BSD device for the student. I think that's so the student can understand how presentation looks.
Dr. Monod?
Yes.
I'm Dr. Reza. I want to comment on Kawasaki disease, echocardiography.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Briefly,
yes,
sir.
Madam, briefly. Madam, Fatima, Madam, show us the picture of Kawasaki disease with left main artery with a dilatation. It's very nice. But some of our pediatric echocardiographer, they are over enthusiastic to comment on or diagnose as a case of Kawasaki disease with dilatation of the main coronary artery or LAD. So I want to make some comment that please be aware of giving a diagnosis of Kawasaki disease without being very sure. Because this, after diagnosis of a Kawasaki disease of a pediatric patient, the their parents are very much aware and they are very anxious, and they usually not doing the echocardiography for in one center. They usually do it in another center, even outside the country. So we have to be very sure, we have to be very cautious about to comment on Kawasaki disease with coronary artery dilatation. It is my advice for all pediatric echocardiographer or adult echocardiographer patients who are doing the echo with seeing the coronary arteries, the proximal part of the coronary arteries. I am very much thanked to Dr. Noonar Fatima to show the actual dilatation of the Kawasaki disease of a patient with coronary artery dilatation. This is my comment.
Thank you, sir. We have with us Dr. Mohammad Kobiruzzaman. He is one of the leading echocardiographer in Bangladesh. I request sir to make some comments as well as to give briefly answer to two questions asked from the participants. One is, how can we assess the measurement of PDA from the suprasternal view? Number one. Number two, what actually the term aortic mitral continuity and discontinuity means?
Actually, okay, I will answer this question. First question is the measurement of the PDA from suprasternal view. Actually, ideal view is the PDA view. Ideal is the PDA. If you don't get any proper image of the PDA, then you can go for towards the suprasternal view. But it's not a recommended or the easy approach for measurement of the PDA. It is the PDA view, and sometimes the short axis is modified. These are the good views to image the whole PDA. Actually, you have to play with your transducer in different position. In whatever the position, you get the proper image of the PDA, then you can measure it. The mitral, pulmonary end, the aortic end, and the leg. This is one issue. Another issue is that the so long PDA shows the continuous left to right shunt, it does means that the pulmonary vascular resistance is not irreversible. It is closable. This is one thing. Another thing, regarding the coronary artery disease image, first you have to decrease the sector width. That will make your resolution more clear. And you have to decrease the depth. So this is a technique. And you can make it zoom. Another thing for Kawasaki disease, you have to look for irregularities of the lining of the coronary arteries, the diamond dilatation and irregularities. And next thing is the continuity. Actually, during the embryonic period, there is persistence of two infundibulum. One is connected with the pulmonary artery, another is connected with the aorta. And in course of time, the infundibulum that is attached to the aorta, that is get resolves, and it almost completely resolves. So LVOT diameter lengthwise is only 2 to 3 millimeters. It is, in other sense, it is a part of the fibrous skeleton of the heart. But if there is persistence of the infundibulum for both for the aorta and the pulmonary artery, then it goes towards the dual. Now, whenever there is the aortic mitral continuity, how can you decide in your practical life? Then you just have a look for the fibrous skeleton. There is a fibrous continuity between the mitral valve and aortic valve. So there will be no muscle tissue intervening between the mitral valve and aortic valve. So whenever there is any muscle tissue, what raises your question is, there the mitral insertion and aortic valve cusp insertion, is there any long length? Then your visual perception, then you some, there is some strikes in your mind, is there any outer mitral continuity? Then look for different view, different view to measure the size. Actually, someone says that the 5 millimeter or more, it is the parameter for declaring that there is outer mitral continuity. This is the one thing. And for DORB, it is a, if it is not top priority, that the madam have already mentioned, actually, the how much completely the infundibulum between the below the aorta is being resolved, that depends upon the degree of DORB. In top, the desorption is almost complete. So we can assume that, that there is aortic mitral continuity. But some of the literature says that if you histologically study it, you will get some types of muscle tissue in the aorta, in the in between the aortic valve and mitral valve. This is the, so for diagnosis of the aorto mitral continuity, you have to measure the right coronary cusp of the, from the insertion of the right coronary cusp of, sorry, not coronary cusp of the aortic valve and the anterior mitral leaflet. The length will tell you that is there any aorto mitral continuity. Regarding other things, the BSD, someone was raising their hand to type of BSD, size of BSD, male alignment, restrictiveness. In the last 23rd August, I delivered a lecture elaborately in IPDI. I think those who are interested, they can listen and hear the lecture to clarify their or enrich their knowledge. So thank you. Thank you, madam. You have delivered an excellent lecture actually in one topics. That is not possible to cover all the things. I will tell one thing. Those who want to study or at least a minimum level, maintain a minimum level of reporting the congenital echo, then one should study one standard book of echo thoroughly. That is my message. It is a knowledge and observation and the demonstration that will make you some sort of level. Otherwise, only the observation, only the hearing, it is not possible to make a comprehensive knowledge to comment in expert level. Thank you, Manohar. Thank you, Muzumdar.
Would you recommend one or two books for the adult echocardiographer for pediatric or congenital echo?
I'll tell all things. Then, whenever I first start echo in Scotts, Delhi, I used to go to the pediatric lab. I was frustrated. And I tell this, Radha Krishna, I want to learn pediatric echo, but whatever you see the inverted image, I get frustrated. I can understand it. Then he suggests me one workshop book or pediatric workshop. There is a very fantastic guideline. I can think, you can get the photocopy from me, those who are interested. One book, another book, there is a Rebecca Snyder. This is a very tasty book, elaborately described.
Luminous.
SL, you can understand it. This,
thank you, sir.
Adult coronary amazing sample can be told.
Yes, yes, sir. Sure.
There is a provision for separate protocol for visualization of coronary artery in E9 GA system, number one. Number two, if someone want to learn about the visualization of the coronary artery, patient with aortic regurgitation will be ideal patient for him. In those cases, the coronaries are hugely dilated, and they can delineate the coronary. Number three, the apical portion of the left anterior descending artery can be well visualized in a modified four chamber and short axis view, and that is the view from where the coronary flow reserve can be measured. And in some centers, there is a stress vasodilatory echo which measured the coronary reserve in that view. We had a student who has done his research on this visualization of the coronary in the listening country. So this is reality. Number four, the people in the ICU, the anesthetic guy, they are also very, very handy in their echocardiography.
And
they're very, lot of advancement in their field. In ICU, when the anesthetics do their transesophageal echocardiography, postoperatively, they often have to look at the left circumflex artery, because as a result of certain surgery, there are injury to the left circumflex artery. So in transesophageal echo, LCS can be well visualized also. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. Dr. Mohammad Khalekujaman. Khalek bhai, please. Do you like some brief comments? Professor Taufiqur Rahman.
Registration tonight, but I'm going to be a panelist.
Sir, unmute yourself, please. Mozumdar sir, unmute yourself, please.
আমাদের যে ফেলোরা আমরা ডাকছিলাম তাদেরকে কি ভিউতে আনা গেল? ডাক্তার রাজীব
গেল না তো স্যার?
রাজীব, নো আনসার ফ্রম দ্য রাজীব. এনিওয়ান ফ্রম দ্য এক্সিম কো
স্যার বলুন স্যার.
ওই আমাদের যারা হ্যান্ড রেজ করেছে তাদেরকে কি আমরা ভিউতে নিয়ে আসতে পারি?
স্যার একজন করছিল স্যার, নিয়ে আসছি স্যার. আর কেউ হ্যান্ড রেজ করেনি স্যার.
কি জানে, কি নাম জানে ওর?
আশরাফ
আমাদের তো
এখন তো স্যার কাউকে দেখতে
সময় খুব একটা নাই, না হয় আজান পড়ে গেছে.
বরং সালাম স্যার,
সালাম স্যার
হাত রেজ করছে.
একটু আশীর্বাদ নিয়ে একটু দেন আর কি.
জি স্যার, শিওর স্যার, এটা তো অবশ্যই আমাদের জন্য স্যার খুব ভেরি গুড লার্নিং প্রসেস, এবং আপনি স্যার ইনিশিয়েটিভ নিয়েছেন. কিন্তু আমরা স্যার একটু ওই যে আবার মাঝে মাঝে প্র্যাকটিসে যাওয়ার জন্য সবগুলো সেশন অ্যাটেন্ড করতে পারছি না, বাট হোয়েন আই এভার গেট চান্স আই ইউজুয়ালি পার্টিসিপেট. আমি শুনছিলাম স্যার এই এটা আমার জন্য একটু ডিফিকাল্ট মনে হচ্ছিল যে ভিজুয়ালাইজেশন অফ দ্য করোনার আর্টারিস, কিন্তু আজকের এই ডিসকাশনের পর থেকে হয়তো দেখা যাবে যে একটা বই পড়ে আমরা আবার চেষ্টা করবো আর কি স্যার, এতটুকু আর কি. বাট ডিসকাশন ইজ ভেরি নাইস অ্যান্ড ভেরি নলেজেবল. থ্যাংক ইউ সো মাচ স্যার ফর গিভিং মি চান্স.
থ্যাংক ইউ স্যার. শাহাবুদ্দিন স্যার আছেন? শাহাবুদ্দিন স্যার, প্রফেসর মোহাম্মদ শাহাবুদ্দিন. শাহাবুদ্দিন স্যার
আছে? আছে. ওয়েলকাম শাহাবুদ্দিন.
হ্যাঁ, থ্যাংক ইউ স্যার. আই এম প্রেজেন্ট ফ্রম ভেরি বিগিনিং স্যার, দো আই এম ডিসকানেক্টেড সেভারাল টাইমস. থ্যাংক ইউ ভেরি মাচ স্যার এন্ড মনোয়ার, এন্ড থ্যাংক ইউ ভেরি মাচ ম্যাম ফর ইওর এক্সিলেন্ট প্রেজেন্টেশন, এক্সিলেন্ট টক. ইটস এ ভেরি সিম্পল ওয়ে টু আন্ডারস্ট্যান্ড দি এবিসি অফ ইকোকার্ডিওগ্রামি পেডিয়াট্রিক session. Madam always talks very brilliantly, very nicely and very lovely. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you.
We are proud of you that you are also a SOMCN. So I am not a SOMCN, but I still teaching a post in the SOMC for last more than one decade. So we are proud thank of you, ma'am. You. And thank you very much for your excellent presentation. And thanks to Govindo also.
থ্যাংক ইউ স্যার. জিল্লুর ভাই, জিল্লুর ভাই কিছু বলেন. জিল্লুর ভাই আনমিউট করেন, কিছু বলেন.
জিল্লুর কি নাই নাকি? আমাদের আনিসুল
রহমান, তৌফিক রহমান.
তৌফিক কোথায়?
প্রফেসর তৌফিকুর রহমান সবাই চালাক হয়ে গেছে, এটা আনমিউট মানে লিভ না করে এইভাবে রেখে অন্য জায়গায় চলে যায়।
Excellent presentation from madam. There is no need of cardiac cath.
তুমি আনমিউট করো, তুমি আমার
I have a question to the madam regarding madam's talk. Madam told that actually there is no need of cardiac cath before procedure, but I felt some problem in cath labs. Just like I give an example, that day before yesterday, I asked, I tried to attempt to close a PDA in my cath lab, but after echo, I have seen that there is a very good size PDA, it's 3.5 × 2.5 millimeter. But after doing cardiac cath, I have seen that there is a rudimentary PDA on the pulmonary side, but good size on the aortic side. So I feel puzzled and I feel problem in my cath lab. So madam, can you talk about this issue?
Thank you. Are you a pediatric cardiologist or adult cardiologist? Just to know.
I'm a cardiologist, but I do regularly some sorts of
congenital intervention. Thank you. So about the PDA, you know, there are Krichenko classification of PDA about the size of the PDA. So some of the PDAs are tubular, some of the PDAs are conical, some of the PDAs are twisted like this. So your PDA was a conical one, which one has wider diameter on the aortic side, but it was very narrow on the pulmonary side. So in those cases, you can't do from the prograde approach, right from the Bennett's approach, you can't cross the pulmonary artery from the pulmonary side because the pulmonary end is very narrow. Now you have to see whether you need to close this PDA. If it is a too small, you don't need to close it. If you are, then you have to calculate the QP-QS ratio. If it is more than 1.5, then it is a significant QP-QS ratio and there is too much flow to the pulmonary end, which is more than 1.5 times than that of the systemic flow. So in that case, if it looks small, sometimes it looks small, but shunt is high. So in that case, you have to close. So what I do in those cases, I just do it retrograde. So I just close the thing from the outside, from the femoral artery approach, and I place the coil. So it takes only like, you know, if you are an expert, coil closure from the retrograde approach needs very little time and you can do it very quickly. And in this approach, you will be able to cross the pulmonary artery. You will place a co-catheter, multipurpose catheter. You will engage it on the side, then you will give a terumo wire. That wire will easily cross the PD on the pulmonary end. Then you will forward the catheter over the wire to the pulmonary artery. Then you will remove the wire and you load the coil in the loader and you will cross through. So I did one case. Actually, today I was talking to sir. We had a very interesting case this morning. I am not doing any cases, but one of the patients, he was mad. He was just like a mad. He has a BSD and a PDA and he is a journalist from some place and he was pressurizing me like anything. And then I was also scared that maybe he can report or something because we are doctor and they are telling you doctor and you are not listening to me. You are doctor and you are scared of corona. So I was so much pressurized. So today morning I said as I am coming here for some other purpose, so I will do that. So what happened? That was a very, very bad case. And I was very unlucky that this morning I had a lecture. I had not prepared that yet because I had no time in the office. So I thought morning I will prepare it. But I went to the cath lab. I thought it will take 10 minutes for the BSD and 10 minutes for the PDA. But it was like 1.5 hours. The BSD was a perimembranous one, very difficult to cross. It was very difficult, just below the aortic valve. And I was like sweating from head to toe just to cross that BSD. So that was done. After that, I thought PDA is only a 5 minutes matter for me because I will do it from retrograde as it is a small PDA. But to my surprise, I found that that PDA was originating from arch of the aorta and it was a right-sided PDA. It has communication only with the right pulmonary artery. And I failed to cross that several times. And I thought I am leaving that because I have a program at 10 o'clock. But at 9:30, I crossed that. And I did that successfully. And then I called sir, and that I finished. So this is the reason why I am here, because I am too much pressurized. I was too much pressurized. And I did that successfully, BSD and PDA. And patient is fine now. So after this program, I will see this patient and I will leave. So you will be able to do that, but not from the prograde. It should be done from the retrograde approach.
Thank you, madam. I think Nuralam bhai can make some comments.
Monor bhai, madam ekta sundor kotha boleche je third eye develop kora. So third eye develop korte hole to ashole dedication lagbe. Etai amar kache ajker message mone hocche. Je kono bishoye dedication dorkar tahole third eye ta develop. Dhonnobad madam, dhonnobad Mojumdar sir and Monor bhai.
Thank you. We are already at the end of our session. May I ask Professor Abdullah Shafi Mojumdar sir to make some comments and conclude the session.
Dhonnobad Manohar. Amar to notun kore ar proshongsho bani dewar words nei for Professor Brigadier General Nahar. She deserves all the praise and the thanks and gratitude from us. I hope that in the next few sessions, amra shobai ekhane uposthit thakbo. Tale amader encouragement hoy, inspiration hoy. Jodi amader desher pothito josha sob cardiologer uposthiti amaderke inspire kore. Mane amader ajke to 12 week. Mane amader hoto aro ontoto 8 প্রোগ্রাম আমাদের হতে করতে হবে, আমরা যদি বিভিন্ন আমরা এটাকে এক্সটেন্ডও করতে পারি, আমরা যেটা চিন্তা করছি হয়তো কেস বেসড কিছু স্টাডি করতে পারি। আজকে যেটা মনে হলো প্রফেসর নুরুন্নাহারের দৃষ্টি আকর্ষণ করছে, আপনি সে ইকোকার্ডিওগ্রাফিতে একটা এইচডি আপনি ইউ ডায়াগনোস উইথ দি ইলাস্ট্রেশনস এন্ড ইউ ডু দি পারকিনসনস ইন্টারভেনশন and after that you do again the echo. A series ta jodi apni ekta ASD series ekta PDA series ekta BSD tinta case amader hoyto 1 ghonta lege jabe jodi you describe it very slowly and elaborately. Ei dhoroner korle hoyto aro ektu amader bhalo hobe. Amar mone hoy je apni eta ekta preparation nen je case based tinta case representative tinta case jara amader adult cardiologist er jonno dorkar. ASD BSD PDA apni close korechen. Before that, what the echocardiographic findings are that? After the procedures, what do you find? কিভাবে আপনি এটা করেছেন? এইভাবে একটা হয়তো আমরা প্রোগ্রাম রাখতে পারবো। তো আপনি আমাদের সময় দিলে আমরা এটা একটা টাইম আমরা সেট করতে পারবো। তো আজকে আমি সবাইকে ধন্যবাদ জানাচ্ছি, যারা আমাদের অনেক সিনিয়র কার্ডিওলজিস্ট এবং যারা ইকোতে ডেডিকেটেড সবাই আছে, যারা ফেলোস তাদের কাছে আমি বলি আজকের প্রেজেন্টেশনে আমার দুটো কিন্তু মেসেজ। নূর আলম যেটা বললো এটা তো একটা মেসেজ যে ডেডিকেশন, এটা কমন মেসেজ যে ডেডিকেশন ছাড়া কিছু হবে না, কিন্তু কতগুলি কথা মনে রাখা আর কি। আমার কাছে কানে লাগছে যেটা প্রফেসর নূর নাহারে যে যদি ইকোতে আমাদের অ্যাওরটা এবং পালমোনারি আর্টারি একই ক্রস ইতে দেখা যায়, একই প্লেনে দেখা যায়, তাহলে ইট ইজ এ টিজিএ। মানে কতগুলি এরকম প্রত্যেকটা ডিজিজের কিছু কিন্তু টিপস বিটস আছে, যে আমরা যে একদম খুঁজতে হবে এটিজিএ তা না, কিন্তু এটা একটা ই যে আমরা বুঝলাম ডিটেল করতে হলো, আমি হয়তো পারলাম না, আমি রেফার করলাম যে ভাই এটা তো টিজি মনে হয়, কিন্তু টিজি আমাকে ডায়াগনোস করে দিতে পারবে। আরেকটা হলো যে কোনো লেশনের সাথে অ্যাসোসিয়েটেড চেম্বারস এর কন্ডিশন যদি আমরা দেখি তাহলে কিন্তু আমাদের অনেকগুলি হেল্প করে। আমরা একদম অন্ধের মতো এইচডি দেখতেছি বা ভিএইচডির দিকেই তাকিয়ে আছি তা না করে আমরা যদি আরেকটা যেটা বললো আমাদের মধ্যে কে প্রফেসর রেজা বোধে বলছেন খুব সম্ভব যে আমাদের পেপারস পেশেন্টের পেপারস করি সবসময়, এটা আমি নিজেও বলি সবসময় ইসিজি এক্সরে পেশেন্টের হিস্ট্রি এটা হাতে নিয়ে যে আমাদের ই করতে বসা উচিত। আজকে আমার মনে হলো যে আজকের আমাদের ডিসকাশন গুলিতে এই বেসিক কথাগুলি উঠে আসলো। আমরা তো ডিজিজ কেউ কাউকে শিখে দিতে পারে না, কিন্তু ডিজিজ এর প্রিন্সিপালস গুলি যদি আমরা জানি তাহলে আমাদের জন্য এটা কাজে লাগবে আমাদের জন্য। তো সময় আর নাই, আজকে খুবই ফ্রুটফুল আমাদের প্রায় ঘন্টা তিনেকের একটা এত লেন্থি কখনো হয় নাই কোনো প্রেজেন্টেশন। আপনার প্রেজেন্টেশনটার জন্য আমাদের যে অ্যাসোসিয়েটেড ডিসকাশনস কোশ্চেন আনসার্স সেগুলির জন্য আমরা ডক্টর গোবিন্দ পালকে হি ওয়াজ ভেরি মাচ রেডি টু প্রেজেন্ট হিস টক, কিন্তু he was generous enough to agree to postpone his lectures from the later date. As I also thank him for the understanding of the situations and the cooperating with us with these words. Among fellows der jonno abaro boli je you have to interact ebong amra chai je ei somosto lecture guli kintu amra junior doctors and the young fellow der jonno karon তারাই হলো দেশের ভবিষ্যৎ। প্রফেসর নুরুন্নাহার তো আর কত বছর কাজ করবেন, হয়তো আরো গুলি উত্তর করে দিয়ে যেতে হবে। তো এই জন্য আমাদের এই এইগুলি আমাকে উৎসাহ দেওয়া আর কি, এনকারেজ করা যে ইউ ডু ইউর ডিউটি। আমার মনে হয় কিছুটা আমরা সাকসেসফুল হচ্ছি যে ইকোতে আমাদের যে কাজ করতে হবে ডেডিকেট করতে হবে অনেক শিখার আছে। আমরা বেসিক পড়াই আবার ওই হরাইজনটাও দেখিয়ে দেওয়া হয়, এটা কিন্তু আসলে অনেক দূর যেতে হবে। কাজে এইগুলি সব আমার এই প্রোগ্রামে যদি আমরা সাকসেসফুল হই তাহলে আমাদের এই এই প্রচেষ্টাটাকে মনে হবে যে সার্থক হবে মনে হবে। তো এর সাথে আমি বেক্সিমকো ফার্মাসিউটিক্যালকে বিশেষ করে এর সাথে জামশিদুল হাসান রাজীব ওতপ্রোত ভাবে ধন্যবাদ দিয়ে মনে হয় যে আমরা এখান থেকে শেষ করতে পারি। সবাইকে লিঙ্ক থাকে, সবাইকে ধন্যবাদ। মনোয়ার we can leave now.
So we can now leave and we pray for everyone's sound health. Thank you all.
Thank you.
Dada, apnata shuna opekhay thaklam dada. Govindo da.
Of course.
I'm sorry na Govindo.
No,
I was hesitant je what should I do. So you gave me the opportunity to tackle this situation. আমাদের সিনিয়ররা যেরকম দিবে টু ফলো দেম আর জুনিয়ররাও দিবে টু ডেভেলপ দেয়ার ক্যাপাসিটি। আপনি দুনিয়াতে যে দেখবেন যে এত সুন্দর সুন্দর লেকচার দেয় মনোয়ার প্রায় গল্প করে স্যার ওর লেকচার একদম অভিভূত হয়ে শুনলাম ওর আসলে কেন হয় ওরা কি এই আকাশ থেকে পড়ে আসে নাকি কনজেনিটালি তারা অ্যাকোয়ার্ড করে আসে তা তো না, তারা কিন্তু হয় কি এখানে এসে লেকচার দিতে দিতে আমাদের লেকচার দেওয়ার স্কোপই তো নেই কারণ আমাদের শ্রোতাই নাই, কেউ শুনতে চায় না। আজকে হয়তো শুক্রবারে শোনার চাইতে হয়তো ইকুই করতেছে কেউ কেউ বসে বসে বিভিন্ন জায়গায় ইকোর প্রোগ্রাম ইন্টারন্যাশনাল ফোরামে হচ্ছে, ইন্ডিয়া থেকে কতগুলি ফোরামে হচ্ছে, আপনি অনলাইনে গেলে কিছু পাওয়া যায় কিন্তু ওগুলি শিখেন। আর আমরা এগুলি তৈরি করছি যে রক্ত মাংসের শরীরের মুখ থেকে শোনাটা আবার একটু আলাদা মনে হয়, সেই জন্য আমরা আমাদের লেকচারগুলি তৈরি করছি। এটা না শুনে গেলে ওই থার্ড ক্লাস ইকো করে এবং আমি জানি না জীবনে কোনোদিন হবে কিনা, একটা রেগুলেটরি বডি দিয়ে যদি আমাদের প্র্যাকটিস রেগুলেটেড না হয় তাহলে কিন্তু কোনোদিন ই হবে না, মেডিকেল সায়েন্সের ডেভেলপমেন্ট হবে না। আমাদের একটা টাইম আমরা পারে আসছি কোনো মতে, কিন্তু ওই টাইমটা তো ভবিষ্যতে এই ওই রকম ভাবে প্র্যাকটিস করানো ঠিক না, যে কন্টিনিউয়াস আমাদের ফিনিশিং করতে হবে কন্টিনিউয়াস। আজকে তো শিখলাম, আমার মনে হয় আমি জানি না সবাই হয়তো কিছু না কিছু দুই একটা লাইন তো শিখছেন, একটা প্রেজেন্টেশন থেকে দুইটা তিনটা লাইনই শিখতে হয় আসলে, সব শেখা যায় না, ওই দুই তিন লাইন শিখলেই মনে করবেন যে উই আর হ্যাপি। এই যে কবিরুজ্জামান কত সুন্দর সুন্দর কথা বললো, তুই নক কত সুন্দর সুন্দর, রেজা রেজাকে তো পাওয়াই যায় না, এটি যাওয়ার লাক দিয়ে রেজা এগ্রিড এন্ড হি স্টেড অল থ্রু। না রেজা তো you have got the potentiality but you did not participate with our
endeavor. All rounder sir,
you always
this is Allah
Allah
all rounder now all rounder kintu amader participate na korle amra to ekটু সাহস পাই না
ইকো শেখার এনআইসিবিটি তে রেজা স্যারের কাছ থেকে অনেকটা আমরা যখন এনআইসিবিটি সব ভান্ডা নিয়ে আসতেন তাই পিছনে গিয়ে থাকতাম ধরতেন আর কি, এখন ব্যাক বেঞ্চার হয়ে যেতে পারি।
ইয়েস ইয়েস মোনার
খালেদ মোহসিন, ওরা মানে দে আর মাই ইন্সপিরেশন, আওয়ার ইন্সপিরেশন,
সবসময় ওরা